Welcome back to the Masters of Endurance 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing. Join us with just under 6 hours to go. The standings are as follows. After 452 laps of being completed, in X-Racing Red leads by a minute and 50 seconds, Commander SimSport in second, third Core Motorsports, fourth in X-Racing Blue, fifth Glacier Racing, Iberica Racing Team in sixth, seventh Team Camaro 2, eighth Madcal Racing 2, ninth Virgil Racing, and tenth Radicals Online Team 2. The are only two cars on the lead lap, that's P1 and P2 in X-Racing Red and Commander SimSport. The rest are one, or two, or three, or something like that, to 7 laps down. And right at the back of the currently still running cars, yeah, there are cars sort of 34 laps down. But still in the race, and so still eligible to score points.
Actually, the number 114 car, which is the 34 laps down you mentioned, they're going to get over 420 laps, it seems, if they keep going. And because of that, they'll actually hit the 70% and therefore get points. Not sure the exact number, so they probably want to go all the way up to 430 laps, but I think they're already somewhat reaching it.
Look back at car 46, still the closest battle on the track, Peter Ridley for Infinity Esports, still fighting with Alex Adzana Garcia as they head into the bus stop. It's the black and green BMW in the background, the Infinity Esports car, and the pure, the green factory car, McLaren, that's just exiting that corner now.
The Infinity Esports car has been pretty much just riding the bumper of Dream Factory the past 5 to 10 laps. Haven't actually been able to make a move or anything on them.
Yeah, it looks like he's giving it a go now. Finally had the opportunity to outbreak him into Lacoon, but Garcia holds on, but has been now passed. And I think we'll see the Infinity car accelerate a little into the distance now. And behind them is Mohamed Patel in P7. The Team Camaro car, which has been, well, it's taken full advantage of the issues that happened to other teams overnight, and has ended up in a pretty good position up there in 7th.
Yep, they have Core Motorsports. They actually got some damage earlier in an incident, but they were running 3rd. Virgil Racing's been falling in between 4th and 9th. Iberica Racing have also fell in between that as throughout the race, well, throughout the night, I should say. Glacier Racing have, for the past, I would say probably for the past 5 hours, have been in anywhere between 3rd and 5th, so they've been doing a good job. They actually got a tow bug not too long ago, so, which actually, I'll introduce Alexi Aloma for Glacier Racing. We were just mentioning you guys, you had a tow bug very recently. Was it just simply when you got out of the car and the next person got in, it was just started towing?
Yeah.
All right, now Kimmy. But I guess you guys still are trying to shoot for possibly a podium, if not 4th, 5th position.
Yeah, it would have been like, now it's pretty hard to get the podium without mistakes from the Core and whatever, the Inex car, but it's still possible. It would have been much more possible without that bug, but yeah, we'll see.
Have you had any sleep so far, or have you been awake for the whole race?
No, I haven't slept yet, but I actually just set an alarm for 2 p.m. GMT. So, yeah, I will get some sleep soon.
Did you have any? Did you find driving more tired meant more mistakes, or were you pretty pretty consistent in your stints?
I think I was faster on my last stint.
Wow.
Were you just more relaxed?
Yeah. Yes. I'd say that.
Yeah, you have slower reactions when you're tired, so maybe you don't overcorrect and stuff.
Yeah, but the first thing, you have to get sideways first. And I was driving like really easy. Like, not really even trying. And the car was just on rails.
I noticed that actually. You guys went from, I believe you started 17th, might be wrong with that. And you're in the top 10 rather quickly.
Yeah, I think I was 5th. Before my first stop. Or was that even what you were asking? Because the stupid spotter was talking.
No, you're right, you're right. That's pretty much what I was asking about the first stint, essentially.
But my favorite moment so far was I don't know if it was my favorite, but I found it funny. I was passing Butel in his McLaren in my Ford, and I was thinking like Butel really would like to swap the car with me. But I'm
I think he wanted to drive the Ford actually.
Yeah.
So is I don't know who's driving the rest of the race for you guys. It's 6 hours, so surely you're kind of organized for the final 6 hours.
Well, I know that Riku runs one stint more, and then I think we will wake up the Valtteri for I don't know how many stints. And I guess Valtteri takes it to the end.
Also joining us in the commentary box from Marlborough Motorsport is, and I apologise if the pronunciation of this is wrong, which it will be, Yunus Huhaka.
Don't freeze in the middle of it.
That will be actually correct. Hello, yeah. Jonas Puhakka in Finnish, but yeah, that's close enough. Hello, it's been nice so far, and I want to thank Alexi for his amazing Kimi impression.
I think the more tired a person gets, the more they sound like Kimi Räikkönen, no matter where you're from. You just want to say less.
Well, that's not necessarily true. I mean, I don't feel tired at all. I slept like 2 hours in the last, about 30 hours or so. And I just drank some coffee with some energy drink and mixed some milk in it, so I'm fine.
Coffee. What kind of combination's that?
Yeah, that sounds disgusting.
It is, but it keeps you awake.
Oh man. One of those nasty concoctions right there.
Yeah, and yeah, I mean, it's been quite fun so far. From our point of view, I see you're following Mikko around now. It's Mikko Niittymäki, because just in case you don't know how to pronounce his last name, it's quite difficult.
Niittymäki.
Yeah, that's close enough. I mean, that's just fine.
Actually, that is close to what I would have pronounced it. Actually, I have just a couple Finnish people on my team, so I'm used to the crazy names. It's the French ones that I still don't get.
What, like someone like Romain Grosjean?
Ah, Romain Grosjean. I like him. It's actually weird. I liked him when he first came to F1. I still like him. But all the flack that he got for, well, all of his incidents, especially here in 2012, I don't know, I still liked him for some reason. And yes, as JB pointed out, Romain Grosjean is Swiss.
Yeah, but Swiss and the French, I mean, Switzerland Switzerland actually has four official languages, but go ahead.
We just had a car, Dream Factory just had an accident, just in front of you guys, actually. They just went off at the entry to Eau Rouge, and they've had to teleport back to the pit lane with major damage. I'm just going to see what happened. Oh, wow. Oh, there was a collision. Yep, they had a collision. Do you want to get a replay for that? Because it's worth watching.
Yeah, I'm able to get a replay.
Yeah, this will be an interesting watch. You can see they're alongside one of the Mad Cow cars. It's the BMW.
First
Mad Cow. There's another Mad Cow up ahead of them. So they're still alongside. Now they're going to head into Eau Rouge side by side. On the entry. This is not how to do Eau Rouge, unfortunately. And there you go, contact and roll over. So significant damage. Luckily, still in the race, it would seem, but a long pit stop. Yeah, that happened just in front of your driver. You guys are up in 28th. You started 50th, so that's quite a good progression, I think.
Yeah, and we had also had the towback happen to us during the night once, so we lost around 40 seconds there. And yeah, aside from a couple of incidents, we've been doing fine consistently, and I just wish we could, like, clone Mikko and perhaps put some Mika Lirkki in there. And clone Mikko and have him drive for 24 hours and we've been in the top 10, I think.
It's a bit of damage on the front of your car. Is that general wear and tear, or was there a bigger collision during the race that you might need to fix?
Well, actually, it made the car better. What happened was, it was during my stint, actually, ashamed to admit. And we had a bit of collision entering the bus stop chicane with the number 33 car. Not with the number 33 car, but we had a bit of collision with the McLaren, who was a lap behind, and he was overtaking me from the outside. And we had a collision entering bus stop chicane. I spun through the grass and hit number 33 right in the side, nose first. And luckily, we didn't bend the steering or anything. It just bent the front of the car. But for some reason, the car is now a bit faster, actually. I think Mikko said he's able to drive around half a second faster at the start of the stint, so yeah.
Oh yes, I think Core Motorsports posted a video of that on YouTube, actually, so I think I saw that. It was unlucky for everyone involved there. But that's what happens at the bus stop chicane. It does tend to cause issues.
At least you weren't I believe it was GP3 car that just went flying through the air there.
Yes, trying to take off to fly home.
Yeah, I've seen that GP3 crash as well. It's actually quite funny. At first, I thought the driver was Finnish and trying to just, find his way to the home planet.
Wow.
So in the championship, Marvel Remote Sport, now on the standings, you have... You scored 29 points in Suzuka. Was that your first race, or did you also compete in the first round?
Well, I didn't compete in either of them because Nitomäki having issues with... Actually, he had to drive from the floor in Road America qualifying, and he could only put in like 2 or 3 laps, so we failed to qualify because it's our qualifying ace. And then for Suzuka, we actually competed, but I wasn't driving for the team. We had, I think, Harli Turunen, Mikko Nyttömäki and Mika Lirkki, I think, driving for the team 10. And yeah, this is pretty much my first endurance race for this team, and I've been enjoying it so far. And yeah, the points are good. I mean, maybe I haven't followed the standings. We got 29 points in Suzuka, and if we get some good points here, I think we don't have to qualify, no?
Correct, yeah, if you're in the top... top 30, right?
You don't have to pre-qualify.
Yeah,
yes, you'd be locked in. So I have to set a qualifying time.
Okay, so that will be a major relief for us.
Tell us about the process of picking the car for this season. Was it always going to be the BMW, or were you thinking perhaps McLaren or Roof or full GT?
Well, you know, it was always gonna be the BMW pretty much. I mean, I've driven GT3 badly, but have driven it in the BMW, in the iRacing. And I think Mika has driven the BMW too, and Mikko has also driven the BMW. So I think it was pretty straightforward decision. I mean, looking inside, I mean, the Ford would have been an interesting choice. Because from what I've seen, the stream has been going on for, I think, 18 hours now. And for those 18 hours, 17 and a half have been showing their Glacier Racing for GT. I mean, the guys have been doing well, but we had a good laugh about it.
Yeah,
okay,
we're big
say
fans.
A quarter of it has been before GT. I believe we just had a spin up ahead. Can't tell who that is. Someone in Pujon just spun and hit the wall. I'm pretty sure I heard it.
I'm just going to try and find it. Oh, no, I can't find it. Yes, we have spent a fair amount of time also talking to the team as well, but yes, I think we're just fans of the Ford GT. It's always been the same this season. We just should love that car.
We get quarterly updates from them, I think you could say.
How was Hagner's English?
Oh, good. Perfectly fine English, in my opinion. We've known him since MOE and LFS, so actually pretty good.
Okay, that's, well, I don't want to be rude, but that's surprising.
If you read his forum post, you'd think it'd be terrible. But now when he talks, it's fine.
Yeah, I mean, Agner's, even though I give him some bit of rude words, but he's an awesome guy, really. And as are all the Finnish guys on Glacier, knowing some of them quite well, I mean, big props to them. They're really awesome racers and awesome people in general.
Have you gone to any of the Finnish meets?
Yeah, I have. I think.
You think? You're too drunk to remember, maybe?
There happens to be some photographic evidence of me wearing a wig and a towel and nothing else. So yeah, I think I have gone to one of the Finnish meets.
Sounds like you lost a bet.
It's good.
No, I actually won it. You should have seen Kyle lost it.
Ugh.
Car 25, Monster Energy, is limping back to the pits, currently on the grass with big damage. The car is crabbing. He's nearly up to the bus stop.
I think I just got my answer on who crashed in Pujon.
Yes, I think so. Yeah, that car very, very slow. Felt like cars just spun at the bus stop. The car can't turn right. In fact, no, it can turn right extremely well. And anytime you turn it right, it will turn a full 360 degrees. Whew. So do you guys... Mongol Motorsport have a website or anything you want to mention?
No, not really. I mean, we're pretty much a small operation. Running just about the only only in the Masters of Endurance. And I actually don't smoke Marlboro. I just want to put it out there. I quit smoking 9 months ago. Well, quit and quit, switched to vaping, but yeah. What I do want to mention is, from a driver's perspective, regarding the large amount of incidents we have seen in the past half an hour, these are actually the most difficult hours for a driver, because at the start your heart rate will be around 300, and you will be like, oh my god, I don't want to crash, and you'll be concentrating. But when you've been up for 18 hours just driving around, you don't think so much about your team or your the possible consequences of crash and how much preparation you put in. You just kind of go into automatic mode. But the problem is that when you go into automatic mode, the kind of guard goes off, it can be a good thing regarding lap times, but it can also lead to situations such as two cars entering a route side by side.
Yeah, you just don't think. Like, by the time you realise what's happening, you're already out of control. And in fact, we've just had another accident. Car 29, Steve Buchheim of Team Heuskenveld Engineering, that car was in P29, lost it at the exit of Blanchimont and crashed into the tyre barrier. Made it back to the pits, but a big damage on that car 66. Yeah, there's lots of damage on lots of cars throughout the field. We've all had incidents.
Yeah, they're actually running quite comfortable in the top 30. Very quietly, actually.
So I'm surprised about the slow Finns, who had had a rocky start to the race, currently up in P24, so obviously had a very consistent overnight shift and managed to come out of it looking pretty good.
Yeah, well, everyone else would make a mistake, so they were just cruising along.
Well, her name is an oxymoron anyway.
Oh yeah, it's impossible, isn't it? Yeah.
No, I mean, I'm a living proof that it's actually possible. And some of the slow Finns guys, they're actually pretty good drivers. I mean, they're pretty consistent, and I was looking at their lap times because we were racing them at one point pretty equally, and I was looking at their lap times and they're just being really consistent. Not slow and quite consistent, and they haven't done any big mistakes that I'm aware of. So yeah, I mean, consistency is the key in a 24-hour race.
Yeah, I think that's a great way of putting it, actually. Being conscious is key. It sounds silly, but yeah, having some awareness is, yeah, pretty important. That Monster Energy car that was in, that had a crash at Puan a few laps ago, still in the pit lane. A very long repair job on that one, or a very long tow and then repair job on that one. The GT Ross orange car is still sitting in the pit lane, I assume, but that shouldn't be there, right? They're out of the race. Is that correct?
Yes, GT Ross guys are definitely out of the race. They just have their car sitting in pit lane. I finally figured out what happened to NX Racing Blue. Sounds as if they got some form of like refueling bug, where, I don't know if... I'm guessing that's what happened. The fuel just didn't add, even though they had fuel there.
Oh, so that had to make two pit stops in a row.
Yep.
That is unfortunate. How much fuel? That's lost them probably 2 minutes.
Probably. That or, yeah, a long time. Almost yep. A minute and a half.
That puts them down in sixth now. Jason Lovett at the wheel of that BMW.
And now I'm gonna have to charge hard to get back through the field. I think Alexi Loma might have jinxed him there, so they had to make some mistakes.
The closest battle on circuit, I think, is car 59. In fact, I think we're looking at it. Yes, we are. Yes.
Been watching it for the past three laps or so.
Excellent. Yeah, that's Sven Kresma you're looking at. He is the Pure Racing Team number 3. Car 59 chasing down Christian Schick of Race More Kraut Racing in P17.
Yeah, it has been successful. It got it all the way down to like 3/10 of a second, then it extends back to a second, then it comes back down. They're not really making any ground on each other.
The Kraut Racing car pitted 3 laps ago, whereas Pure Racing are on 12 lap old tyres. And just ahead of them, not just ahead of them, in fact, yeah, the Kraut Racing car just dispatched with a lapped car, that's CTC Racing 2, Sam Doble, at the wheel of the 119 BMW, the John Player livery.
So have the Bianca Racing team, which have just pit, or well, are in the pits right now, doing a driver swap, Pablo Lopez now in the car. Vortex Simracing also pitting.
From what I recall from last night, Iberica had a drive-through for consistent off-track incidents.
Yeah, and they got another later on.
Oh, really?
Yeah, wouldn't be surprised if they get another by the end of the race.
Is that a lag thing, or is it because of being...
No, it's happening too often to be that.
We've got a spin at the bus stop, car 114 in the middle of the road. The Vortex Sim Racing car. It doesn't appear to be, well, it could be damage related. That car has got big rear end damage, lost it in the middle of the corner. Car's sort of floated sideways.
That car is definitely pretty damaged.
I still haven't worked out which of the Vortex cars it was that had the Eau Rouge crash about 3 hours in.
I want to say it was the 20 car. Because I'm almost positive that Joel Gibbs was driving at the time and he's driving that car now.
I'm just actually going to, now the part two of the race is up on YouTube, which everyone can watch at youtube.com/Masters of Endurance. I'm going to go find out.
Have Glacier Racing currently 24 laps into their stint, while Alexander Voss for Core Motorsport only about 9 laps in. So Alexander should be gaining quite a bit here. Don't think they'll be able to pass him or anything like that before Glacier pits. We shall see. I don't know how I'm going to stay up for another 5.5 hours, but we're going to do it.
I've got the energy now. You can just, well, not sleep, but go into hibernation mode or something. Yeah, I wasn't due to come on the... I wasn't expecting to be awake until about 11 UTC, but woke up at about 9, so thought I'd come and help you guys, because, yeah, I have turned on the stream and you sounded...
we've been really tired. To be honest, every time Deco went to speak to me, he's actually going to get a shower right now because he was dead. Every time he went to speak to me, like in whisper or something like that, he wasn't making any sense. I was like, you gotta type it, you're not making any sense at all. So he's extremely tired, and I know because he always works odd hours anyways for work, so this isn't really helping him. And then Boothie's not used to staying up this late. So yeah, he's actually getting a shower as well. He's pretty dead to the world currently.
I'm glad we have updates on the hygiene status of our admins.
Yep. I am unfortunately not able to get a shower. I might get one after the race and then go to sleep instantly. Or I might just take a sleep in the... I'll take a shower and sleep.
Take a sleep in the shower.
Yeah.
I'm still scrolling through the video of part two. I still haven't found the moment where Vortex had their off. Sure, I'll get there eventually. Let's go through about an hour of video so far.
I think you're gonna find it too easily.
Nope. We have a slow moving car on the straight, the Kemmel straight. That was Team Huskyvold Engineering. Ringo Bright's currently at the wheel of that car. Oh, it just came out of the pits and was just taking it as easy as a few lead lap cars or higher up cars went past. So no issues there.
Yes, they
had a big off. So yeah, they just finished repairing that. I love looking back at this stream on YouTube because, for whatever reason, the way the video gets compressed makes the race look almost like real life. Which I really like.
Alexander Voss gaining almost a second. Oh no, gaining over a second this lap. This past lap.
Oh, we just had a spin. Car 25, Monster Energy. We've just come out of the pits. Off again, This was through Fanier, I think. That Monster Energy car, yeah, in the wars. Still P37, though.
Yeah, they're clearly, whoever's driving that car is starting to make mistakes.
I think they had a drop. I think they've switched since the last, since they had their previous damage. I believe it's a different driver at the wheel. It's currently Joel Demontio. So, oh yes, thanks for joining us in the commentary box today. Ines Kruhaka, by the way, from Marlborough Motorsports. Enjoyed having a chat with you. Your guys up in, still in 27th, and you're about to get in the car, aren't you?
Yeah, I'll be getting there in approximately 20 minutes, so I need to get some warming up done. Maybe drink another cup of that coffee and sprint mix, and I'll be there. Yeah.
Brilliant. Well, good luck, and yeah, hope you enjoy the rest of your race, and you don't overdose on energy drinks.
Yeah, thank you, and good luck with the staying awake thing.
Good luck. Coffee, energy drink, and milk.
Nope. Ugh. Disgusting. That sounds like a punishment.
Oh my goodness.
Cause all you need really, if you want energy, just have a double espresso and that'll do.
Yeah, that'll do something more.
No need for extra energy pumping through your veins. But whatever, what I keep them awake, I guess. I'm still scrolling through that video.
Oh, wow. Apparently, see, Ricky is going to do one more lap. He'll be pitting this lap. So, Alexander Voss will most likely either ride behind him this next lap or try to overtake him. Probably depending upon how close he is through here. Seems about right. 4-5 tenths exiting the source. He can get a good enough run through Eau Rouge. Doesn't look like it. Oh, and he's...
Whoa! It's a Glacier Racing, their first major incident of the day.
Oh, this isn't good.
That's big damage. But the exit of Radion. Just, well, the car is still moving, but that is a lot of damage to have to repair. We're just going to get a replay of that.
Currently have it up now.
Pretty much. So it's fairly straightforward. The car seems to float as it goes over. Oh, the car is now stopped on track. The car floats at the exit and... Oof.
Oh, and he hit that curved piece of the wall too, so it was even more of an impact.
Yeah, if he'd spun a little bit further down the road, it would have been a less of an angle, more glancing blow on the Armco. And yeah, the car's now been towed back to pit.
Oh man, that's big.
That had Hans, well, they were under pressure from Core Motorsports, who have now inherited that third position. Alexander Voss now takes up the P3. And that will also help Inex Racing Blue as well. Probably Iberica, and possibly Team Camaro as well, and Virgil, depending on how long this pit stop is. There's a lot of damage.
Yeah, it's very unfortunate for Glacier Racing. Been pretty much having a spotless race. To be honest, if they've used their fast toes, I don't even know what it's been for, because they've had such a clean race, so... But I highly doubt they're going to have any.
So the next battle on track that has potential to be flaring up is the 91 car up against the 18, up against the 59. That's Team TTL versus Pure Racing Team number 3. Matthew Hill currently at the wheel of the TCL McLaren.
Yeah, it's either going to be Team TTL catching or um, or Pure Racing Team 3 catching Race More Kraut Racing. One of those two things are going to happen.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, Team TTL have been going a little bit faster the last couple of laps than... Oh, in fact, we had a spin just ahead of the TTL car. GTRS Orange in position 41 spun at the exit of bus stop. That's Aurelien Fago on board that car.
Yeah, they're trying to just secure as many points as they can. Anybody in front of them that crashes off, they're going to get points for it.
Pure Racing currently lapping at around the same pace as the Kraut Racing car ahead. That's Christian Schick at the wheel at the moment. The Team TTL, the Australia-based team, this is prime time for them, although Matthew Hill was driving yesterday as well, so I imagine he's tired and not really working with Australian time and more working on the Masters of Endurance time.
Yeah, this is pretty much an all-day race for them. It goes from 3 a.m. to 3 a.m., so... Well, for most of the people there who are on the east portion of Australia. I don't actually think either of the teams are gaining on the ones in front.
Yeah, she looks like the gap is pretty much stable. It's interesting that the battle, or the lead gap between NX Racing Red and Coanda SimSport has pretty much remained unchanged for the last 45 minutes.
Don't worry, it's been pretty much that exact same thing for the past 6 hours almost. So, it's been a long time coming there. Just to see it be exactly the same.
It's obviously consistent driving from Laurent Battille. You were getting pronunciation lesson on that before I came on, but I think I missed the actual answer.
Yeah, I can't do it.
Excellent.
I can't do it, unfortunately. I'll have to have some practice for next race.
I can't actually navigate my camera to Glacier Racing.
Yes, they're actually not on the track right now. They're, I assume, letting their car, either they're retiring, which would be extremely unfortunate.
Yeah, because I can't actually see the car anymore.
Yeah, or they're letting their car repair. Riku did disconnect, so this might be the end of their run here.
Can the car still be repaired while someone is disconnected?
Or... I think so.
So they should be getting a replacement driver in once the repair is done. Yeah, I'd be surprised at the end of the race if the car can continue and they're on for some very good points. I'd be surprised if they were out of it. Cool. I'll be with Matthew Hill as he navigates his way around this Spa-Francorchamps circuit. We'll just let you ride on board for this lap. See how he takes the lines and see if you can spot any mistakes where he could improve, and maybe you can let him know. So the Glacier Racing car is now back on track, or back in the game at least. So it will be, yeah, we'll have another one of their drivers back on board. I think it's going to be Yari Latari, from what I can tell. So that car is still getting repaired. This event supported by Blue Flag Racing, who are providing the prize money for this race. Visit facebook.com/blueflagracing to find out more about the team. They're currently on they're searching for new drivers, so if you think you've got the right sort of personality and you know, maybe a bit of speed as well, then drop them a message. This championship also supported by IGP Manager. We'll be giving away some more codes for that later on, so keep an eye out for that. And also Derek Spear Designs as well, who are providing prizes for the end of the season too. The Track Boss, a very cool piece of kit, will be going to the winners of this championship. Next round of the season is currently penciled in for the 31st of January, the 6 hours of the Circuit of the Americas, sponsored by GrandPrix247.com. And then 3 weeks after that, on the 21st February, the season finale, a race that I am very much looking forward to, the 6 hours of Bathurst. That race will be sponsored by IGP Manager as well. So is it normally possible to tell how long damage will take to repair? So is there sort of, can you estimate based on size of impact, or is it pretty much iRacing decides whatever it fancies?
iRacing decides whatever it fancies. I'm guessing it can somehow tell what the damage is, and then it kind of just makes a guesstimation. I don't know what you want to call it. To decide how much time you actually get to repair. But yeah, we can't tell. I mean, there are some people who they slam the wall and they have 5 minutes to repair, and then there's some people who get tapped and their race is over. So, never really know.
Yeah, just little things, little iRacing uniquenesses that make it a little unpredictable sometimes. So we're still on board of that Team TTL, Matthew Hilcar, and he is now properly catching the car ahead, the Pure Racing Team number 3 car. Last lap he was some time fast. It was about a second. No, 0.7 of a second quicker, bringing the gap down to just over a second. Yes. That would have woken him up a bit.
Yeah, it got it down to 1 second. Now another mistake.
He got it back once and then lost it again. I wonder if that's reaction times.
Simply overheated the rear tires there.
Yeah, he sort of lost it on the way in, which is an interesting one, and then lost it in the middle as well, but got away with it.
Currently on board now with the 119 CTC Racing 2. Should be making a move on the car directly in front of them. That's the Team Camaro 1 car. Team Camaro 1 on old tires and CTC Racing 2 on new tires.
Yep, you're on board with Gernot Frisch? Yeah, we'll deal with that. Yep, in that BMW, and ahead is Jamie Wilson in the Team Camaro car. In 30 seconds, he's trying to put a lap on the Vortex Sim Racing. Not trying to put a lap, actually, possibly just being lapped by the Joel Guez Vortex Sim Racing number 20.
I believe Joel's only 8 laps into his stint, so.
Yeah, I think Joel just lapped him because he's lapping quite a lot faster than them, but just got caught on the straight because of the slipstream. But now it's Fletcher having a look as they head through Puan.
Has a good run here, actually, in the corner. Might see... Nope. I was going to say might see a little move here.
A little bit squiggly out of the corner for Jamie Wilson. Just breaking traction a little bit. But remains ahead in his McLaren. Good run from Fritcher. Looking at the inside into Blanchimont. And Wilson does not fight the issue, but he could still go on the outside. Nope, he's let that one go. So that's 32nd place for CTC Racing Car 2.
Yeah, now we're going to jump back to Matthew Hill here. Back to about a half a second behind Sven Kresmer for Pure Racing Team 3.
Yeah, he had Hill had was within touching distance of the Pure Racing car, but then made the mistake a lap ago, but has already made that time back up on this lap. So I'll expect him to probably have a go on the next lap, I reckon.
Switch here, but the 77 car, they're just interviewing them.
Yeah, Marlboro Motorsport, 27th, now looking to pass the All-Star Racing number one car, that Roof, with Robert Bergnauer currently behind the wheel. And it's Nitti Mäki who's driving the Marlboro car. They're due in the pits in about 10 minutes. Behind them is a Ham Endurance car that's some way down the order in 40th. And it looks like this Marlboro car could be shaping up for a pass at the end of the Kemmel Strait.
That's actually what Matthew Hill just did to Sven Kresmer. Got the pass done pretty much before the corner.
The place for them now, if we go back to the 77 car, probably about to do the same.
Yep.
On the inside. And he breaks later, gets it slowed down and hooks up into Lacombe and takes that 26th position away from All-Star Racing. We've got roughly the same stint. The Marlboro car is 20 laps into its stint, whereas the All-Star car is 26 laps.
Yeah, All-Star car is about to pit, probably this lap, maybe the next lap if they push it. Oh, also while you were gone, I say this now because I see Scott Michaels has just gotten back into the car. Yes, he has got back into the car for R4R Motorsport. He actually did five hours and 15 minutes, or 6 hours and 15 minutes, in the race, straight, overnight.
Wow. That is a proper night shift.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
Yeah, I used to get tired after one and a half stints. So, yeah, five or six stints in a row is just absurd. I think it was partly a mental barrier thing to it, because I knew that I wasn't that great at driving for more than an hour and a half. And as soon as I knew I was past that hour and a half, I'd go into some kind of stupidity mode where I would just make horrific mistakes. That is why I'm not an endurance driver, and not a DWC driver, and not a good driver.
Currently the lead battle is still around that 1 minute 50 range, currently 1 minute 53 seconds.
Yeah, NX Racing Red have been leading pretty much all night, since about the third or fourth hour. It's been a really, really good run from them. And with the demise of Team Redline, it throws the championship, well, everyone who finishes well, all these top five cars that have a chance of overhauling Team Redline, because to retire in 24 hours is just a nightmare. So many points available, and they're not going to get any of them.
Yeah, it's definitely something. The double points in this race should definitely have to be, I guess, it just adds to the patience level that you need to be. And they can, very, very conservative.
Into the pits comes the next Racing Reds, Laurent Mateo. Possibly for a driver swap, maybe?
Maybe. I'm not sure why they're pitting 25 laps into a stint. I'm guessing, I don't know. Maybe that's just what they need to go to the end, and they know that.
So 5 hours to go, or just over 5 hours to go.
The gap actually between second and third, it's pretty much one lap.
Yeah, and they're pretty much on the same pace. Calandra and Core Motorsports currently neck and neck in terms of. Isaac Price takes over the InX Racing red car.
I wasn't expecting that. Actually, yes, I was. I don't know what I'm thinking for saying that.
Brilliant.
Just came back recently from a sleep, so makes sense that he'd be driving.
So we're currently watching Marcus Lindemann from Toyota SimSport. He was just negotiating his way past the NWSS Scarlet car of Tim Klessens. And pulls into the pits. That's after 25 laps.
Yeah, so maybe same strategy after all.
Yeah, maybe they're shifting to be in line with InX Racing Red, perhaps, maybe. Who knows?
I think it's a spot where you just want to, you know, cut a lap each stint now and do it that way instead of at the end of the race just having, you know, 5 laps less on a stint or something.
You'll see him drive past the Glacier Racing car that's still under repair, and it's been there for probably about 15 minutes at this point. That car has fallen a long way down the field, down into
26th,
and I'm sure it'll fall even further once this pit stop is finished. Don't forget, you can keep in touch with us on Twitter, hashtag IRMOE, and the username Masters of Endu. We're also on Facebook, facebook.com/Masters of Endurance, and on YouTube as well, where the first 5 parts of this race, the first 15 hours, are all now up online for you to watch. If you have any moments you want to go back and see, go to youtube.com/Masters of Endurance. I imagine in a bit we'll be giving away another code for IGP Manager, so we'll give you a heads up when we're about to do that. You can do it now, in fact. So in a moment up on screen, you'll see a code. That code can be used at igpmanager.com. This is for new or existing users. Enter that code, one use code, first come, first serve. And that will unlock a year of a subscription to the 2D pack on the service, which is worth $50. The code that you now see on screen, the last character is a zero, not an O. So good luck to whoever gets that one. Thank you to igpmanager.com for their support of Masters of Endurance.
Currently looking at Matthew Hill, who once again is gaining back on race more route racing after his incident that we saw earlier where he oversteered and went off track.
Indeed, yeah, on his way back, he's 3.1 seconds behind at the moment and currently lapping about 0.6 of a second faster, currently on the 24th lap of his stint, whereas the Kraut Racing car is the 20th lap of its stint. So we'll probably see him into the pits before he has an opportunity to make a pass.
Yes, but then also he'll have fresh tires, so we'll see. Could do pretty good after that. Possibly even pass him in the pits.
That TTL car started by Dylan Sharman, then Richard Hamster took over for a long stint. Matthew Hill, currently behind the wheel, had a double stint. And then Ian Travis took over, then Vale Riches, then back to Dylan Sharman. Yeah, overnight they had a fair amount of driver swaps, making sure no one get too tired.
Yeah, they split everyone up pretty well. We've actually noticed that from most teams. We were talking about that earlier, in X-Racing having 5 drivers, and Coanda actually having 6. Also want to note the Glacier Racing car is still sitting in the pits, currently in the 29th position.
It'll be Joni Hagner who takes the car out of the pit lane once it's finished repairing.
Matthew Hill already has his gap down to 2.3 seconds. 2.2 even.
The next battle to watch out for at the front will probably not be for a while yet, but Inex Racing Blue in 4th and Iberica Racing Team in 5th. Iberica currently
7.5 seconds apart.
Yeah, the gap coming down just ever so slightly every lap, so there might be a battle on its way, you know, in the next hour or so.
Actually, we have a battle on track right now.
You're kidding.
High Revs Racing and Cracks Racing Team.
Yep, there they are. So two blue BMWs, the one in front, the darker blue car, it's Cedric Vinsack of Cracks Racing. Behind is the light blue and yellow and red High Revs Racing car with Premislav Dinovsky. Currently driving in position 30. Ooh, actually there was a bit of an issue there. Dinovsky tried to let the Pure Racing 2 team pass at Blanchimont and lifted off, but the Pure Racing driver Lundberg didn't interpret it that way and got stuck behind him, so there was almost a collision, but everyone got away with it. That's the McLaren you can see there, just behind that BMW. He's now going to let him through into La Source.
Yep, hopefully then he can get the McLaren's draft.
Well, he's been really very passive there, actually.
Yeah, that was definitely giving a lot of room.
Because up until that point, yeah, he had been catching the cracked racing team. But, yeah, he's fallen quite a long way behind now after that. But, yeah, probably wisely just to stay out of trouble. Another potential battle incoming is the car 84 Hellenic Racing Team. We've just gone into fresh tyres. Should be catching the Trinity Motorsports car soon. In fact, yeah, I think they might even catch him right now as they head on to the Kemmel Strait. As you can see on
Nestoras
screen.
Nestoras has a run.
Yeah, Nestoras in P23, about to pass that BMW of Trinity Motorsports, Angelo Pater, who doesn't fight the issue and is now down to 23rd. But he's on much older tyres, so it makes sense to let that Hellenic Racing Team car through. The slow Finns just set their fastest lap of the race.
Ah, future champions right there.
Jari Kokkola got a 2 minute 19.9. It's pretty good lap.
Very good lap.
Left it late on to set that time, but it doesn't matter too much. Yeah, that puts him pretty much in the same region as all the other guys in the top 20.
Now see Team TTL, basically right behind Race More Kraut Racing.
Yep, and that Kraut Racing car is going to be getting a bit of a tow from the kind of SimSport car that just lapped them both. But yeah, it looks like Matthew Hill is going to have a pretty good run in his McLaren. Behind him is one of the Mad Cow Racing cars that is going to lap him soon, but he doesn't have to worry about that now. Oh, and then... Oof, the Kraut Racing car pulls over and lets him through without incident, but that was braking on the straight, never the best idea, but Christian Schick decided that he didn't want to fight and let him through.
Sort of a sensible thing to do really in that regard. You sometimes want to fight at this stage of a race, but at the same time, 4 hours 50 minutes to go, you're running out of time to recover from incidents if you have them, so it's a very good time to drive conservatively.
So that voice, that mystery voice you just heard, is Oscar Hardwick, who rejoins us this morning. Welcome back, Oscar, and congrats on your, I think, two wins in your British Touring Car R-Factor event yesterday.
Two wins and a third, yes, which was a nice way to do it. And my teammate won the third race, so I think over the last 2 days at that that particular racing site, we have won 5 out of 5 races that they've run, which is quite good.
Nicely done.
Yeah, although I see that in all them, the top three has not changed since I went to bed about 11 hours ago. 10 hours ago, rather. So the top three still running relatively consistently, although we have dropped class here since I've last been here.
Yes, indeed. They had an accident about 25 minutes ago, lost it on the exit of Radion, and destroyed the car. The car, I think, is still in the pit lane. Yep, the damage is less so than it was earlier, so that car ready to go soon, hopefully. But yeah, they've dropped down from, they were third at the time of the accident, and are now 35th.
I also saw that Team Redline seemed to call it a day after their incident last night.
Yes, after the Enzo Benito one, they ended up calling it quits.
Oh, so I thought, I didn't realise it was not enforced. I assumed that the game had written them out of the race, or the engine had broken.
I think they were repairing, but it was 20 minutes of repairs or something. It was going to put them back down to 45th position, so at about 10-12 laps down.
Okay,
which was incredibly unlucky. They had two incidents in quite quick succession. In fact, Enzo was in the car because of an incident that the Team Redline car had already had quite quickly, we think maybe even through a fast time. Enzo got back in, he didn't actually manage to finish the stint that he was driving before having his own accident.
Just looking back through some of the tweets on the hashtag RMOE. We had one from Yari Litari a couple of hours ago, before the accident for his teammate. Some 6 hours and 50 minutes of driving for me, he said, and more to come. Hashtag my wrists hurt already. Hashtag slow but steady. We also had a nice picture from Athens Gomez Siliban, who tweeted a picture of Romat Alcala, at the wheel of his car, with the live timing up on the next to his cockpit. And Luso Racer tweeted he loves the 24 hours of iRacing, so yeah. So do we!
I have a three-way battle right now for position.
What?
Number 109 of Cracks Racing Team, number 92 of High Revs Racing, and also the number 119 of CTC Racing 2.
Yeah, they've all come together at the same time, yeah. So those positions are, that's a battle for 29th place. High Revs Racing, the car in the middle of that, is 4 laps into their stint, so they're on the freshest tyres possible, so you'd imagine they would probably have a good chance of passing. And that's Dinovsky currently driving that car. And the car at the front of the queue is Cedric Finsack of Cracks Racing, who is 20 laps into a stint. And the car at the rear is Gennard Fritscher of CTC Racing 2, which is 14 laps into the stint. That's the black BMW at the rear. Apparently Pure Racing Team 2 has had a problem in the pit lane, but as we're just going to see Dinovsky make a late lunge into the bus stop and gets that 29th position from Finsack and Cracked Racing, and in fact Cracked Racing to lose another position from the CTC Racing BMW as they go side by side across the start finish line. If Fritscher can break later, which he does, He should get there 30th, but he's run a little bit wide into La Source, but I think he's... No, he's not kept the position. He has very much lost it, and now he's under attack from the Vortex Racing car, which is a few laps ahead. That's Joel Guez currently in that car. So yeah, there's a problem for Pure Racing Team 2 in the pit lane. They got stuck from a glitch in iRacing, it looks like. And now it's Fritsch for CTC Racing, finally passing Finsak down the Kemmel straight. Should have it completed before they get to Lacombe, which he has done. That battle has now resolved itself.
Also sounds like maybe Glacier have got themselves stuck in pit lane, judging by the IRC chat. Yari Latari's saying something about them being stuck in the pit lane and not being able to get back out again.
Yeah, I can't... Oh yeah, their car is currently not on track again. So yeah, it had been in the pits getting repaired, but it's no longer on circuit.
Unfortunately, the only way... Only time we've seen this before is all the team members had to leave the server, and then once they come back, it all worked.
Fingers crossed that works out for the teams currently in a bit of strife with their various different pit lane bugs and things like such as that. They do happen, and particularly when you're looking at being 19 and a bit hours into a race, that's when bugs issues really do start to crop up. So joining us in the commentary box now is Neil Heckens, and I'm sure, Neil, that I have said that incredibly wrong.
No, that was pretty good, actually.
Pretty good. Now, I understand that you're a pretty integral part of the Neo Endurance series. So someone not unlike Michael Booth and Phil Diaz, who's very much involved in now running these newfangled endurance series over in iRacing.
Yeah, I'm one of the founders of Neo Endurance. We started in 2013 with some single events because iRacing didn't have the World Tour events anymore. And we have grown a lot since then. And now we're having the Neo Endurance series with also with driver swaps, 6-hour races.
Yeah, I understand as well that with the driver swaps also came almost a junior formula for you guys, the gathering of tweakers events following around your main series as a support series, a junior series if you like, so that you can actually get more people involved in the endurance racing and racing.
Yeah, exactly. Unfortunately, we had only room for 43 teams and we never expected to be that popular, so... gathering the tweakers asked us, hey, can we help you out or make a series to help you and give a lot of other teams still the chance to run, have some great racing.
So both series currently underway, I think about midway through at the moment. Be interesting to know which teams have been doing well and succeeding over at Neo, if they're transferring any of that success here in MOE.
Yeah, of course, Koan, the SimSport, is at the top right now. They were second at Sebring, I believe, and they won the previous race at Koda. Virgil Racing is obviously very fast, but they had big problems at Koda, so they were 8th there. Radicals Online is also always at the front. And I think that's about it. There are some other teams, Chimera have they're pretty good too. And it's the usual suspects that are running at front here are also running at the front at Neo.
So you spoke a bit there about races at Circuit of the Americas and Sebring. Presumably you're expecting to run a few more rounds, a few more races in the near future. When would those be, and what kind of names do you tend to put money on yourself for winning those races?
Ooh, it's really tough. It's I think in our prototype class, it's a big battle between Radicals Online and Kohanda Sim Sport. These two teams are the teams to beat. But it's really tough to say because anything can happen. We saw that at Koda where Radicals Online crashed out the race in the last hour while leading, I believe. And yeah, it's really tough. You just have to stay out of trouble and just be consistent, and then you will have a good finish.
So in the current Neo series as well, 6 hour races going on. Are they all 6 hour races, or are you yourself planning on doing some 12 and 24 hour marathons in the near future?
Yeah, we're not sure yet. We chose for 6 hours for the first season because it's our first ever real endurance series we are hosting, and also with the lack of day and night transitions, we thought it would be to make more sense to have just 6 hour races for now. Hopefully iRacing could fix that this year somewhere.
Well, I'm sure that if you ask really nicely, they'll look into it. you do never know. I completely agree, it would be a fantastic thing. And if you did see day-night transitions, I think we'd probably be inundated with slightly longer endurance races. But on the flip side, it is very good that yourself, MOE, and so many other groups are taking advantage of the driver swap functionality in iRacing now. And I believe as well, iRacing very soon going to be running the first 24-hour race from their side of things. So again, it's going to be really interesting to watch in the near future.
Yeah, exactly. And driver swaps, it had a bit of a rough start, but how it works, it's pretty awesome. I've seen some driver swap races at R Factor where a lot of teams had problems because while swapping they disconnected and then they could not rejoin, but it seems to be working pretty well. Of course, a couple of teams have problems right now, so that's really unfortunate, but overall I think it's working pretty well and it's pretty easy too, and that's really nice.
Yeah, and you say R-Factor for the longest time didn't have any rejoin feature. A complete separate plugin was made, and it's probably the most important element when it comes to endurance racing. You really do need that rejoin because people's internet rarely runs perfectly for 24 hours and you get easily caught out by it. It's a shame that iRacing currently has a few of these pit lane bugs still lurking about, but at the same time we've had 59 cars start the race and it's only really affected two or three teams so far. And it is a fixable issue, so certainly not the end of the world, and quite a good driver swap and long distance endurance racing environment that iRacing have put together at this stage.
Yeah, exactly. And we have waited so long for this to happen, and they had to change a lot of code behind the scenes. And I think it's pretty good for now. Pretty impressed by it.
Okay, so that just about wraps that up. But in terms of a bit of promotion here from your side, would you like to tell us a bit about your next race over at Neo and Gathering of Tweakers?
Oh yeah, sure. Our next race is next week, also at Spa. So I hope the rubber is still on the track, and we have 6 hours of Spa with Neo, and on Saturday the 3 hours of with the GT3 cars. Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. It's a track everybody knows, and I expect some great racing here.
Well, we wish you the best of luck with running those events. I know that Phil Boothy and Deco, they all very much sympathise and understand what it takes to put these kind of races together. Best of luck with that, and hopefully the remainder of your season runs perfectly well and everyone there has as much fun as they seem to be having here.
Yeah, thank you, and good luck with the remaining 4.5 hours of the race, and I hope you can manage to stay awake with some coffee. I'm not sure how much sleep you got.
I'm not a coffee sleeper. Ow.
I just gotta tell up here. Says enough, right?
I don't have coffee, sorry.
Anyway, Neil, thank you very much for joining us in the commentary box, and hopefully we'll hear from you again very soon.
Thank you.
Just a couple of notes to make as you watch the Trinity Motorsports car and P24 battle with the All-Star Racing machine in P23. The problem that Glacier Racing have had, looking at the IRC channel, is that they might the car is stuck in the pit lane, and the normal way to fix that problem is to have all drivers disconnect and reconnect. But one of their drivers, Alexei, is still connected and is asleep, so can't therefore disconnect. So the car will remain stuck in the pit lane until Alexei comes back and disconnects, which I highly doubt we'll be able to do before the team calls it a day, which is really unfortunate.
Yeah, just one of those things, and the admins have been, very much telling, I think it's them and also, I want to say Cure too. That had a pit racing issue.
Yeah, they're having it right now. They can't
to get everyone out.
Get back in their car.
Get everyone out the server, everyone back in. But obviously, if Alexei's having a nap, that's not going to work quite as well.
Yeah, I think this will mean people now realise that if they're not going to be around, they need to not be connected to the server, just in case this happens, because it's, iRacing is not forgiving. It will do whatever it wants, and it will ruin your race. But yeah, it's been just mentioned by Admin Boothie, who says they have completed more than 70% of race distance, so they will be classified as finishers and will score points. How many points they get? They'll probably be around 41st, I would say. Because there are a lot of cars behind them that have already retired, so yeah, they should be classified 41st. Which is probably no consolation for what could have been a podium position.
Which I want to say is 21. First, Phil Boothie, correct me where necessary. 19.
Double.
There we go.
And then you have the double.
Oh, okay.
38.
Passo's more on than I am. There we go.
Maths.
It's unfortunate because I have a maths exam on Tuesday. So.
Yeah, I should bring a calculator. It's
we
fine.
Just learned that you're going to fail.
Probably. I like to think not.
You can see now on stream, Blue BMW, Trinity Motorsports, Dirk Reinhard still battling with Harold Stadler of the All-Star Racing Team. This battle for P23 is the roof ahead that the All-Star car and the Trinity car behind, the Blue BMW. So they make their way down the hill through Stavolo.
Been following for quite a few laps here. Big off track there by the number 3 car.
Good to see people running this closely after so many hours of racing.
Yeah, I think there was while we were asleep, I think there was a fair amount of time where there were cars pretty much spread out completely and there was not much going on. But yeah, I think we've come back at the right time. There's always been something going on the track for the last hour and a half or so.
Also another 91 and 59. 91 on fresh tires, I believe. If not, they were just a lot faster. Yes, they are on fresh tires.
Now that's TTL again. They're always getting in the action. And yeah, they're looking to pass the Pure Racing team number 3 of Sven Kresma. They were battling actually earlier in the race. That was a an attempt at Bruchel. Didn't really come off though. It's Dylan Sharman who started the race for TTL. And just ahead of the TTL car, yeah, the Pure Racing team car is now lapping the Camaro car of Jamie Wilson, and the TTL Dylan Sharman now right up behind as they head into Stavelo. I think we could be looking
Dylan's
at
Dylan's not too happy with that move before. A little defensive here, Sven Kresma.
Yeah. Expecting a move coming out of Blanchimont though. He looks like he's got the speed. Having to brake. And up the inside into the bus stop. That is a good outbraking move, and he has completed it. Sven Kresma does not fight the issue, and is now in 16th position for Pure Racing Team 3.
I'm back to Dirk Reinhardt, Trinity. Currently getting passed by NX Racing Blue. Trying to chase down All-Star Racing.
Indeed, yeah, and All-Star Racing will pull over to the inside at the bus stop, and that has given Dirk Reinhardt of Trinity a good run into the corner, and a good run out of the bus stop as well.
Doesn't look like Trinity Motorsports here is able to make a move on All-Star Racing, kind of just riding behind them.
We have a provisional championship standings update for you, courtesy of Jonathan Palmer, who's just sent me a spreadsheet screenshot. So he can tell you that if the positions finish as they are, NX Racing would take the championship lead by 45 points over Core Motorsports, who would go up to second, and Commander Simsport would be third with 324 points, about 51 points behind the championship lead. America Racing would be fourth, and Team Camaro 2 would be fifth. Team Redline, who had been leading up until this point, would fall a long way down. In fact, I can't even see them on this list. So
they are there.
P12-ish. Yeah, they'd be down in, yes, in P12, exactly, yes, with 190 points. That's the position stay as they are, but there's still 5.5 hours to go, 4.5 hours to go even.
4.5 sounds a lot better to me.
Joining us in the commentary box, and this is a name I'm going to definitely mispronounce, Marty Piel, Pietila, that's as yes. good as I'm going to get from Grander Simsport. Welcome. So you're not racing in this race, but you've been, I guess, watching closely your team recover their way up to second place at the moment.
Yeah, I haven't been driving this. I actually don't do a lot of GT3 cars or any other cars with a roof, but yeah, I've tried to follow what the guys have been doing, and I'm really impressed of what they've been able to achieve after the misfortune and the opening hours.
When they had the crash, and I think it was about two hours in, did they try and shift the strategy around, or do they just want to carry on going as fast as possible? Because they have got their strategy is now back in sync with everybody else. Do you think that was the plan, or is that just, you know, a coincidence?
Well, I'm not entirely sure, because at that point I really didn't want to bother them and ask them stupid questions about what their plan was, but I would assume at that point in the race, so early on, it's kind of a useless thing to start to calculate on a lap per lap basis of what you're gonna do. Basically, 12 hours in the race, you might actually start to think about what's going on, and maybe think about saving fuel or pushing it to the max or anything. But looking at the results sheet, the guys have done exactly what they needed to do.
Yeah, we will be, if it finishes how it is, we'll be third in the championship come the end of the race, which is pretty good. So, for those who don't know, I mean, do you want to tell us a little bit about Kwanda and the other series you guys race in, and what kind of team you are as well?
Yeah, sure. Well, we're a fairly new team. We were formed just at the end of summer 2014, and our main series is the iRacing World Championship Road Series, where we have drivers like Martin Kranke, Andre Böttcher, me, and the new drivers in the team who were joined after we were formed, Rocco Baron and Justin Lindsay, trusting that he will get his pro license, or rather World Championship license in the iRacing Pro Series that's going on now. And besides that series, as you can see, we focus on the Masters of Endurance and Neo Endurance series in the mid-season, off-season of the World Championships. And we also have a pretty functional GT3 division in our team, with Björn Jens and Rens Brockman, who are, as you've seen, pretty decent in those cars as well.
Yeah, indeed, yeah, pretty handy. So are you watching the whole race, or have you sort of been coming back in and out to see what's going on?
Yeah, I've been just checking every now and then. Watching a 24-hour race is almost as daunting task as actually doing it. I woke up in the morning. The first thing I did was check our team's WhatsApp group and saw that what has been going on, and that was pretty pleasant surprise to see our position at that time. I think when I went to bed, we were something like P6 or 7, and slowly starting to kind of pick up the game from where it was after 2 hours of racing.
Yeah, I was always nervous the moment between waking up and then finding out how your team is doing. It's a little bit scary, because you never know what might have happened, if some horrible iRacing bug could have happened, or a crash or whatever. So yeah, it's always a relief to see your team still up there.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's when I check the lead timing or whatever, it's kind of always the issue of keeping my second eye closed, because part of me doesn't really want to see what's going on there, but obviously this what's going on right now is something I want to see.
And what's the mood like at the moment? Is everyone pretty happy with how things are going? Are they sort of still thinking of possibly, you know, maybe the possibility of winning, even though they're a minute and 55 down, there's always a chance.
Well, the mood that I can sense from the guys is more like careful, and I think that's exactly what you are supposed to be at this point of the race. A good gap to the to the third car, and obviously a bit too good gap to the first car. But yeah, 4.5 hours to go, and that's like 3 Grand Prix distances still, and anything can happen. So there's no reason to be happy about anything, nor be kind of how should I say it? Be disappointed or giving up on anything. I mean, anything can happen.
Yeah, indeed. Have you got any? Have you got a website or any shout-outs you want to make while you're here?
Yeah, sure. We have a website, www.coin-simsport.net. I have no idea what that sign is actually in English.
Minus dash, it all works. Hyphen.
Okay. And yeah, that's about it. Until now, check out our Twitter and Facebook and even our Google Plus page. We heard that only bad teams have Google Plus accounts, but we kind of bite the bullet on that one and created one, and we have 22 followers there, and that's pretty amazing.
That's brilliant. Yes, Google Plus, the place to go.
I noticed you mentioned the drivers racing in DWC. I'm guessing Hugo Lewis isn't going to be making any form of return.
You would have to ask from him. The last time I heard that he's trying to, but obviously with the current job that he has, it might be a difficulty, but who knows? It's the wrong person to answer that question.
Oh, okay, I was hoping you could just say yes and kind of pressure him into it, but
yeah, I'm fine. Hoping to say that too.
I miss having him around. Actually, he won the last MOE race and looked for speed, and actually probably the last two seasons he was incredible before going off to DWC here in iRacing.
Yeah, he finds his way on the track. He's actually a pretty interesting driver in that way that when we actually do our practices, he can be good half a tenth off our pace, whatever every single one of us is doing. And then on the race day, 15 minutes before qualifying, he goes and does a Hugo Lewis. I won't tell you what that is, but and then he becomes a half a second faster and gets the pole and wins the race.
Yeah, he used to practice for MOE all the time in like 2009 and stuff, and I think he got pole almost every single time that season, or at least close to it. Just crazy transition actually, because before that, my 3ID and Hugo Lewis, they didn't really win any of the big endurance races or anything like that. And they always, you know, finished like top five and whatnot. And then suddenly 2009 season rolled around. I think Hugo got a new computer or something like that. And just the increase in the FPS and whatnot just absolutely changed him as a driver. Just suddenly he was gone compared to the competition.
Yeah, that makes a huge difference. Actually, my former teammate from Iota Racing, Daniel Lopez, who's also driving in this race, he used to drive the iRacing World Championships with some kind of laptop which had probably enough computing power to print out a Word document or something. I have no idea how he actually managed to do that, achieve results like that with computer like that.
Yeah, I don't understand how people do it. There's a lot of people that actually do it. I know Isaac Price used to race on a laptop. I don't think he still does. I hope not. But he used to. Yeah, there's a lot of good drivers that have that issue. I know they can't maybe afford a computer, but if they did, it'd be amazing to see what they could really do.
Yeah. I mean, there is a definite line when the frame rates or whatever start to kind of hinder the performance of the driver. I mean, if you watch a slideshow, then how can you correct the slide? I don't know. I can't.
Exactly.
Well, thank you very much for joining us, Marty. Really appreciate your time. And yeah, it's good to get an insight into Coanda, the second place team at the moment. So I wish you guys luck for the rest of your race. And yeah, thank you very much for having a chat.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Currently on the stream, you're seeing still the Trinity Motorsports versus All-Star Racing battle that has been raging for the last few laps. It's Harold Stadler in the Roof versus Dirk Reinhardt in the Trinity Motorsports car. The All-Star Racing Roof is 20 laps into its stint, whereas Trinity is 11 laps into its stint.
Sooner or later, something's going to have to happen here.
Yeah, I think so.
We're running like this for a bit too long.
If you head to twitter.com/mastersofendu, you will, we're about to tweet another code for IGP Manager, a year's worth of 2D pack worth $50. It's a first come, first serve code, so be ready for that. We'll be putting it up on there soon. Yeah, go to igpmanager.com to redeem it for new and existing users. And the tweet's just gone up. igpmanager.com/special to type in that code. And it looks like Dirk Reinhardt just letting through the Iberica Racing car, yeah. Just got past both of those guys.
Actually gonna go on board with Dirk here. Maybe that'll push him.
That is a dirty windscreen.
Yes, it is. It seems like he has all the runs through the corners. It's just, I don't know if it's the front end damage, maybe. They don't have the straight line speed.
Yeah, I do wonder, maybe he just doesn't want to pass at the moment. But you'd think he does seem to have more pace.
Yeah, when you're this far back, I think it's... I don't think they should be fuel saving or anything like that. I think they just need a push. Because after they pass the 3 car here, it's a minute and 45 seconds before the next car.
Yeah, true. But you can hear a lot of lifting of the throttle mid-corner. So maybe there's some handling issues.
Sound like he was on the rev limiter. That was really weird sounding.
Yeah, it sounded like I wasn't full throttle. I was on the rev limiter. So yeah, some issues there. Closest battle on track it is at the moment. Battle for P23. Meanwhile, lead gap still in that 1:55 zone. Isaac Price just managing the gap to Marcus Lenterman in the Coanda SimSport car.
I think both of those teams are just taking it very, very easy now.
Yeah, they're the only cars on the lead lap, and in fact, the next car down the road is Alexander Voss in the Core Motorsports car, and he's 2 laps behind. So yeah, those two are now in a class of their own, effectively. Little mistake there from Stadler, I think, coming out of that left-hander. but again, not enough for Dirk Reinhardt to be able to make anything of it. Out of pool and into Fagnier.
Always impresses me how people can be running this fast, this long, this far into an event. I mean, it's faster than I'd be running if I was fully awake, to be fair. So.
It always depresses me, yeah, when you're this far into a race and you, their race laps are faster than my qualifying laps.
iRacing is a sim that I've always struggled with. Like, I've had no issues being competitive elsewhere, but iRacing really, I don't know, either I've not clicked with it or everyone that's good at it only plays iRacing.
I think iRacing is the company you have to commit to.
Probably.
Because of the money.
Like I said, I do enjoy it, I'm just slow.
Yeah. I've sadly not been able to race in iRacing for about 5 months. So my subscription is purely going to Masters of Endurance, yeah, pretty much. In fact, yeah, I just had to buy Spa yesterday, so they can iRacing can cash in on that one.
Yeah, I'm one of the few who loses sleep at night over the fact that they've got 100% of the content in iRacing.
Yeah, wow. I do too.
It's not a nice feeling. Now.
Yeah, I just buy it as and when. I don't care about the multi-buy offers.
Well, once you buy enough stuff, they start discounting it anyway.
Oh, right. Yeah, once you've spent a certain amount, yeah, you get a discount.
So I think, for example, with the Ford Falcon V8 supercar they released recently, which I have to buy again, I'd immediately get 30% off of it or something.
Has that been about $8?
$8, yes, 50 cents? Something like that. I could always go and double check, but I'm not sure. But yeah, if you do end up getting lots of stuff, then you can effectively.
You're basically making a profit at that point.
I think Derek is being way too nice here.
Yeah, I'm wondering if there is an issue, because he's had many opportunities to pass and has not taken them. So there's either maybe a handling or performance issue that he's grappling with.
Yeah, it's bothering me, actually. I want him to just go ahead and get it over with, but he hasn't yet.
So, Dirk has been lapping in the 21s, 22s, actually, more recently, as he's caught up to the back of Stadler. His lap times at the beginning of the stint, and sort of middle of his stint so far, have been 21. So he could be lapping at least a second faster than he is at the moment, if he wasn't behind Stadler, but maybe he just doesn't feel the need to go at that pace.
Yeah, like I said, you do find, particularly now, I mean, we've seen how the mighty have been able to fall in this one with Glacier and Redline hitting pretty severe issues, and it's looking like probably we'll both be out of this race eventually. So, even if you are a bit quicker, how much do you want to risk writing off your car this far into a race, almost 20 hours in, just to make up one position, particularly if that position is 23rd and not, say, in the top five?
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the issue we'll have towards the end of this race, as people have seen how many problems that, as you say, the mighty have fallen. I think people will be very coy and careful. But yeah, this is still our closest battle on track by quite some margin.
Yeah, and if he doesn't make a move this lap, I'm going to have to switch to something else. I can't watch this forever.
Phil Dias being slewder and completely mad. Yeah, give him to the end of this lap, and then we'll go look at something else.
He's just riding along right now, so it's kind of annoying.
Into Stavelot. Sorry, no. that Stavolo's coming up next after these left, right and left-hander. Saying earlier that Iberica was catching in X-Racing Blue for fourth position, that's no longer the case. In X-Racing Blue, instead of pulling away from them now, the gap is 12 seconds. That's between fourth and fifth.
Team Union currently driving for in X-Racing Blue, and he's never been a slow guy. He's always tends to be pretty quick, no matter what he's driving. One of those few people that maybe he's not the best in anything, but he can be really, really good in anything.
Yeah. GT cars, and then he raced in DWC, the F1 car. Now he's racing NASCARs and potentially the Oval DWC as well.
Yeah, very few people have got that specific talent set to be able to drive both the oval and road side of things to such a competitive level in iRacing. Plenty of people seem to be able to do one or the other, but very, very few with one or two. Very few drivers that can do both.
Yeah, and he has the brothers, Jake and PJ Sturgis, who do it as well. So they work together quite often, actually, on oval stuff. And on the road, Timu can normally help more. But to be honest, Jake and PJ know so much road stuff, they don't even really need help.
Seems like you have struck gold at NX then.
Yeah. Well, Timo needs a lot of help when it comes to oval stuff because, you know, he doesn't really know. There's a lot of stuff comes along with setups and whatnot. So, a lot to learn there. And he tries his best to learn it. He does a pretty good job.
Interesting fact, next time that Isaac Price, who's currently leading this race for NX Racing Red, crosses the line, they will be starting the 500th lap of the event.
Sweet.
So currently watching on screen in X Racing Blue's Timo Ivonen, who, as we just said, has been gently pulling himself away from Pablo Lopez in the Iberica Racing Team roof.
Another... Yeah, I think he wants to catch up to the Core Motorsports roof, but I don't think he's going to have the time. Plus, pit stops have to follow his way.
Very true there. And again, it's another sort of one of those consistent displays that I think both NX teams really have been able to display so far this season.
I think it's maybe just the, I don't know, maybe experience in endurance racing. They've done Masters of Endurance, and then you have Coanda, which I look at as formerly My3ID, but you know, a lot of the drivers are from there, and they are well known for their endurance racing as well. So, you know, them two being out front really is no surprise to me. Actually, I expect Coanda, they had their issue earlier in the race, but I really expected Coanda to take this by storm.
Yeah, obviously the setback with the incident early in the race has caused them some issues in that department. We've also got Johnny Hagner saying that we should try and say the name of the driver of the 92 High Revs racing car at the moment.
We should try to say it.
Dinovsky.
Yeah.
Seems close enough.
I'm not even gonna put that up on the screen. So many people's brains would explode.
So it's a tricky one, granted.
Yeah, sure, I'll do it. Actually, give the people something to do. So early in the morning for me. I don't know how it is for everybody else in the world.
Lunchtime. Which is probably where Michael Paskin was just from off to.
I bet you it is, actually.
Also been informed that Isaac Price has entered the pit lane. It looks like Laurent Bettiel has taken over the NX Racing red card, currently leading this one.
Yep, he's now exiting the pits. Coanda in the pit lane now. Also Virgil Racing, you see in the background.
So from here, will everyone be looking to do just 1 hour blocks by the looks of it, or will they still be pushing the cars for as long as they'll go?
You can steal and do some 1 hour, 3 minute blocks, but I think that you'll mainly just see around 1 hour. I don't think there's any reason to do anything more than that.
Yeah, it just seems to have fallen now that the pit window is basically at the four hour to go mark, so I was thinking that you'd probably then just drive it 1 hour at a time.
I think so. I believe that would be only 25 laps. Not positive on that, maybe 24. But yeah, NX Racing Blue's done a different strategy where they've actually been only driving 24 laps, I believe. So it's a different strategy for sure.
Ah. Just briefly there, saw the current racing team in pit lane. And that was... Right, change driver now to Andy Peirce, but we haven't really spoken much about them today, so they're currently running in 21st, I guess, just through a case of being consistent.
Yeah, they haven't really been that far up all race long. I mean, they qualified good, but then after that, there's nothing really too special.
And it's still really Coanda, the breakout performance, having come back from, what was it, outside the top 30 at one point, to be running lead lap, second position.
A shout out to Craig Hunter and the Mad Cow Racing number 2 crew, all the way up to position number 8 currently.
Had one of their drivers in during the overnight. They're all in the land down under. A couple of them drew the short straw, having to be up until almost 2 in the morning down there on a school night.
Work night. But yeah,
same difference.
Pretty interesting, they're actually following Team TTL, another Australian team.
Dylan Sharman in the Team TTL, that orange and black car. Spoke with Sharman a little bit during the overnight.
He didn't actually do that many stints, to be honest. He's doing quite a bit now, but I mean, they've done a good job. I think we saw them back when they were in 27th, 29th position. Now they're all the way up to 14th. So they've done a proper job to get back up through there.
Absolutely, and we do want to confirm that, if it's already going, Car 9, Pure Racing Team number 2, has retired, thanks to Pitbug, and yeah, Glacier is Racing still sitting in the pit lane, just in case.
Same thing. So, it looks like they're stuck in the pits, and no matter what they do, they can't actually drive out of the pit stall. So for some reason, the car is getting lodged there, and they can't do anything about it.
So since this happened one time in the Suzuka race, happened twice here, is that going to happen 3 times at Circuit of the Americas?
I sure hope not. I know in Suzuka, the team disconnected, and then when one of them reconnected, they were able to drive. So, I mean, that must not be working here, but
it definitely was working before.
Looking to see if there's anything on Twitter worth sharing at the moment. Closest battle on the circuit at the moment looks to be about 4.5 second gap that is slowly coming down between 17th and 18th position, the 59 Pure Racing Team 3 car and the number 12 AB Racing Silver car, currently being driven by Mert Uzel and Ricardo Ferreira respectively. I saw a smaller gap briefly, but it was just someone going into pit lane. So it'll be interesting to see now if AB Racing Silver can, again, just pull that gap in. We were talking a bit earlier about not wanting to push stuff too much at this stage, writing off the car with 4 hours to go. If you drop to the outside the top 30 now, you're certainly not going to be getting particularly far back inside it with only 4 hours of racing. When you've got 20 hours of racing, not an easy enough job, but it's a job that you can complete, so it'll be interesting to see how these guys get on. I would say for both Pure Racing and AB Racing Silver, finishing inside the top 20 is the kind of result that they want to hang on to, so probably won't see too much aggression from either team on that front.
Yeah, once they get to each other, I'm pretty sure it'll be mostly give and take. Mostly.
Mostly.
We've had a couple through the night where people are getting really aggressive and it ends up being one of the cars are going to get destroyed.
You can't really afford that in these races. There's no good time to get damage, so getting word that the R4R Motorsports car has had a biggie at Blanchimont, ruining most of the engine, so that I'd imagine by this stage they've used up their free tow, so that could well be game, set and match for them.
What was the team name?
R4R.
They're currently riding around with a perfectly clean car. That's what I heard also from our some words in our ears. So far, our motorsport, the car looks perfectly okay. They must have somehow preserved a quick repair.
To do that, 20 hours into the race is pretty impressive.
Yeah, that is very true. Thankfully, just under 4 hours left now.
Imagine that you're counting down the seconds at this stage.
Yeah, I kept saying like after it's like, under 9 hours to go, 15 seconds into the race, so 15 hours. Yeah, I've been really tired, so.
Start this one on the largest amount of sleep, did you?
And I made the decision I'm actually gonna go to sleep right after the race is over, so, and interviews and whatnot.
Yeah, not a bad decision.
Also, just want to note that the first 18 hours of this race, so basically everything but this current recording, is now on YouTube. Some of them might not be in HD just yet, simply because 3 hours of processing, a lot of time. outside of R4 Motorsport. Let's see who else is doing good. Phoenix Motorsports up to 12th. And we're going to give mad props to them, because if you remember correctly, we did interview one of their drivers. At the time, they were around the 29th position. Now they are up to 12th.
Yeah, having watched Phoenix race around here in the 24 hour race before, they had an uncanny ability, sort of irrespective of damage and everything, to by the end of the race be in a good position. So spent the whole race crashing and being in the middle of nowhere, and then finished, I think it was 4th overall or something. So, like you say, given the double points on offer, this 12th position is going to be really valuable to them if they can hold on to it.
Yeah, that's another thing is, you know, some teams, you know, they joined this race and, well, let's say you're outside the top 30, you finish decent, and you're most likely going to get launched right into the top 30.
Very true.
And you were right about AB Racing Silver. Currently have made the gap down to 3.6 seconds.
I'm just impressed that I was right about something. It's a rarity, that.
Yeah, that is true. Kidding, of course.
Well, to a certain extent.
So, I don't know if you already mentioned this, but in that round of pit stops, the lead gap went down by 4 seconds. Not that means much. It's been around that for the entire race. But yeah, between the driver swap for Commander, the gap went down. And Martin Krunkery took over that car. He's been lapping very quickly, as his first few laps have been extremely fast. A 2:18.6. Almost as quick as the team's fastest lap of the race.
Well, putting him, I think Martin Kronk is probably one of the faster drivers at Coanda. So, obviously, maybe in a bid to close the gap down to Inex Racing Red over the next hour, they've popped him in the car.
I don't think it's going to be that much of a thing. Maybe if he's gaining like 20 seconds a stint. However, I don't think you're going to see something that's huge.
Yeah, maybe they're just putting him sort of, if he can catch by a bit every now and then, it just puts him in a better position if Inex Racing Red has a problem. Stands him in better stead of taking advantage of it.
Actually have Core Motorsports just now exiting the pits. However, we see about 6 seconds the NX Racing blue car ahead. You'll see them for a millisecond on the screen. The Iberica Racing car, which you can see in the background, that is actually also for position.
Yeah, so they're down in, caught in fourth. And yeah, the America team probably about 8 seconds, I would guess, up the road on 19 lap old tyres. But you can see them just, two cars behind, currently negotiating their way past the Monster Energy McLaren.
Oof. Compare here, the top three, the battle for P3, third, fourth, and fifth are shrinking up quite nicely.
Yeah, pretty much 10 seconds between all three of them.
Yeah, I think it's just a BMW 123 currently, and the roofs do not want that. Team Leivonen actually will be pitting this lap. If not this lap, then for sure next lap. They've been doing a different strategy, so I think that's what they'll be doing. I may be wrong on that, though. Up there, he's in the pits right now.
Yeah, that was a 25 lap stint for Timo Leivonen.
Yeah, all teams now, similar strategies. Besides Pablo Lopez here for the Birka Racing team. About 5 laps, different strategy. Just want to note that NX Racing Blue has pit, and with the pit stop, transfer from Team Leivonen to driver Jack Sedgwick. Cannot believe I just said those words. Timo and Jack, actually, they're pretty good friends. Jack's a pretty good friend of ours. He's in Team Speak all the time. And
Moonlighting is an NX driver, though.
Yeah, we asked him. Pretty much, they asked him last minute. Can't actually say. I've been pretty much shielded from the entire team this MOE season. I have no idea what's going on. I just know that I found out yesterday that he'll be racing for us, so. Or for NX Racing Blue.
Well, it's certainly not the end of the world. I mean, I know that Jack now, in terms of sim racing at least, dedicates pretty much 100% of it to iRacing, so he's certainly not lacking in competitive ability. He's a quick guy, so.
Yeah, and that's the thing. He's a very quick driver. We saw him in round one.
Qualified sixth or something.
Yeah, he qualified sixth. Nobody expected that. I didn't expect that. He qualified sixth, and this is probably one of the most competitive fields. I think at Road America, the whole field was separated by like 1.4 seconds, all 60 cars.
It was absurd. It was something silly like that, yeah.
1.8. However, that's still crazy when you think of 60 cars. The top 40 separated by a second, probably. If that. Well, besides the help of Enzo Benito, who decides to ruin everyone's dreams by getting pole by quite a large margin in his McLaren.
Although Team Redline yet to secure a victory in Masters of Endurance.
Just want to note to you, Oscar, that the AB Racing silver car has stabilized the gap, I guess you could say, to Pure Racing Team 3.
Well, it was worth a shot, right?
Yep. Also, Looks like Dylan Sharman has closed the gap. Well, actually, no, he passed R4R not too long ago. He's still in 13th. He's catching Jose Almeida pretty quick. At least I believe he is.
Yeah, last lap. They were lapping about the same pace, actually. And the gap is 43 seconds. So, fastest. Who's fastest on track at the moment? It looks like it's kind of SimSport. The last few laps, it's been Martin Krunker setting mid-219s. Whereas the leader, Laurent Bataille, has been in the 20s. Yeah, he's been lapping in the mid. His last 10 laps or so have been low 19s, and he just went into the 20s in that previous lap. Well, that's probably because he had to lap a couple of cars.
Yeah, traffic should play a huge role, unless it's somehow you're getting it on the straights. So you get a huge draft and then they let you by before the corner. I know Jake Sturgis had an outlap basically that was like that. Or not an outlap, but his first lap during the stint after the outlap hit a lapped car directly in front of him. And he was able to utilize that on his hot lap to gain way more time than what he should have.
Just taking a look at Twitter, hashtag IRMOE, had a tweet from Team Camara. They said, 4 hours to go in the Masters of Endurance Spa 24 hours. Their 53 car is nursing damage and looking for the top 30, whereas their 54 is in P6. And yes, being chased by Virgil Racing. And indeed, the Virgil Racing car currently lapping about half a second faster than the Camara car, apart from on that last lap where they weren't. Oh, no, they were. No, they were half a second faster again. They're about 19 seconds behind that Team Camara 2 car up in 6th. Good position for Camara, at least for their number 2 car. Mohamed Patel behind the wheel.
I guess really the trick again is you talk about teams that are fast, teams that are consistent, teams that have had a bad day. And I think Camara 2, obviously, certainly not a slow team. Also not the fastest out there, but they've been keeping it clean and keeping it sensible the whole time.
Yeah, Team Carrera 2 actually 7th in the championship coming into this round. Had some pretty solid results in the first two races, picking up 72 points in round 1 and 60 points in round 2.
I believe the only people that are going to be ahead of them is NX Racing Red, Coanda, Core Motorsports, and Iberica.
Yeah,
I believe.
Yeah, as it stands, yeah, Camara 2 would be 5th at the end of this race.
Looks like Pablo Lopez has actually dropped back a little bit. He's much later in his stint. He's going to be pitting in about 4 laps or so. 3 to 4 laps. So actually, good job really on not falling too far behind.
Kind of SimSport still remains the fastest car on track. Although he's about to come up against some lapped cars. But doing 219 dead in the previous lap and then 219.3. And the lap after.
Yeah, I think he's just going to push a little bit, see how much he can gain. Maybe pressure NX Racing Red into a mistake if they start to push.
think the last time he was in the car, I'm just having a look back at yesterday's timing. He was putting in relatively good times, but this is about as fast as he's gone all race, actually, Krunker. In his first stint, he was doing 20s and a few 19s here and there. But he's actually much, much quicker this time around than he was the first time. So, yeah. Clearly had some room in the tank in his first stint.
Currently have Vortex Sim Racing in the pits. So pit stops will be starting early. By the looks of it, or at least soon, not early.
Currently riding on board with Jose Almeida of Phoenix Motorsports. That car in 12th right now. Almeida has done 11 laps of his stint. Currently lapping in the 221s. Ahead of him is Pure Racing Team 1, who are lapping in the 220s. And behind him is R4R, although a fair way behind. 46, not that far behind actually. No, he is far behind, yeah, about 46 seconds behind. Lapping in the 219s.
It's a fantastic job that all the teams still running have done to be on track at this point. As someone who's taken part in long races in the past, they're very, very difficult to get through. Just to get through. I mean, getting to the end of these races is an achievement. Getting to the end of these races in a good position is even more than that. So people like Phoenix Motorsports, who you're watching now, but everyone else, and I think it's about 39 cars, I want to say, still running on track, doing a pretty good job.
Yeah, indeed. You know, especially the cars sort of down near the back who've had problems, to sort of have the, you know, the determination to carry on going is ridiculously impressive, because it's sort of in the middle of the night after, you know, 16 hours or whatever, it can be just so, you know, it looks like it's never going to end. And to have that perseverance to keep on going is worthy of note.
Just looking at the various goings on track at the moment, the Berica Racing Team only 9.9 behind Core Motorsports at the moment. Different stint lengths, I think. Yes, Core have just made a pit stop, and Berica are just about to make one. So Berrick will in fact move back behind NX Racing Blue, I would imagine, after their upcoming pit stop in the next 2 to 3 laps.
Yeah, they're a minute and 25 currently ahead of NX Racing Blue, and I think they'll drop back to about 15 seconds behind or so.
I think you could probably expect them to, maybe not get back all 15 seconds, but certainly make it look close over the next stint.
I'm trying to remember what my stupidest ever 24-hour race was, and in fact it wasn't 20, it was, I think it was a 16-hour race, and I did it in an LX6, which was a car in Live for Speed that was like a Caterham style, ridiculously fast, ridiculously difficult to drive car. Not fun, not designed for 16 hours of driving, I would say.
No, I myself did, took part in a 16-hour race. In fact, I took part in a 16-hour race with your very own Isaac Price, Phil.
Really? Oh, is it? I know. Don't tell me. You, Isaac, and Wilco, 16-hour race, Firm Bay Reverse, UFR.
Oh, you're a brilliant man for remembering all of that. Yes, exactly that one.
Yes, that's the same race. I spoke about this race earlier. That's the same race that Timu, who will never admit to, had me drive 6 hours and 45 minutes straight because he didn't have coffee.
Was that also the one where Cattell pulled over for some reason or another?
No, that was actually in Masters of Endurance.
But no, I remember we ended up 3rd in the class that we were in. I forget what class that would have been rated at.
NGT.
NGT. Which was reasonable. I mean, Isaac completely carried the team.
How many times did the car flip over?
When he was new.
It wasn't. It was still better than I was, but it wasn't. He was new. I think I rolled the car twice in an hour in my first stint. It's pretty impressive. So.
For people who don't know what it is, just think of a Mini Cooper with a lot of power, slicks, and if you hit a curb, you'll most likely roll. It's basically what the UFR was in Live for Speed.
Yeah, the center of gravity was about 8 meters above the car.
Yeah, so it was above guaranteed. The ground, above the car.
Yeah.
Oh, those are the days. In the pits. Let's find out where they're going to end up coming out. Jack Sedgwick for NX Racing Blue, just exiting Pujon now.
See, they seem an exceptionally long way back, but then you remember how long the pit lane is and how long a pit stop takes. And really, that minute 20 is quite a good distance to be behind someone making a pit stop. Although Iberica are sort of out of sync for this last 4 hours on their pit stops, it would seem.
Yeah. I wonder how that's going to add up to the... I mean, this is about the point where we have to start thinking of how these pit stops are going to end up. Because, yeah, we've only got three or so pit stops to go after these lot. We have another code to give away for IGP Manager about to come up on the screen. It's a one first come, first serve code. So whoever gets it first takes home the prom queen, as it were. So go to igp.com/special, enter the code. The last character is a zero, and yeah, you'll get a year's worth of TV pack on IGP Manager worth $50. So go.
Gonna note that you see Jack Sedgwick has, I said exited the pits, but has went down the Kemmel Street. did not see Iberica Racing anywhere. That's because they had just exited the pits. I believe you're going to see a 22-second gap.
Yep.
22-second gap in between these two cars. A little bit longer than I was expecting, actually. Seems it took about a minute 45 seconds to do a pit stop.
I was just watching Team TTL, and they just lapped the Phoenix Motorsports car and pretty much shoveled them off the road, which is a little bit weird, through Pouhon. Not entirely sure why, not really necessary. I think they just got a bit impatient. They got away with that without any damage. Yeah.
Phoenix, so.
Oh, that's a fair point. Yeah, maybe Phoenix aren't. They're just frustrated that Phoenix aren't going as fast as them. Last lap, Phoenix was a 2:21, and their TTL was a 2:19. So yeah, that does make sense.
Also, I wasn't going to drink coffee. I'm not a coffee drinker. However, when I said something about coffee sleep earlier, or sleep coffee, or something, I don't even know what I said earlier, I realized that I needed something. So I wouldn't sound like I'm hallucinating here on stream. Therefore, I have made myself some coffee.
Oof. Is it like a terrible coffee?
No, I ended up having to mix it with something, because I personally hate coffee. I can't stand it. So I ended up doing like the French vanilla or like a mocha type thing.
Oh, right. I thought you were going to say energy drink.
No. What was the one? Coffee, energy drink, and milk. You weren't here, Oscar.
No, but that sounds like it would rot your soul.
Yeah, Finnish driver for Marlboro Motorsport.
Oh, yes.
If I saw his name, I would tell you it. I currently forgot. Johannes Pukkola?
Yes, that's it.
Yes, he uses coffee with an energy drink and... I've already forgot the third thing now.
Milk.
In order to create something that will help him stay awake. He said it doesn't taste good. He said it's actually awful, but it will keep him awake.
I'd rather just fall unconscious at the wheel than drink that, to be honest.
I think a better choice, it's quite expensive. There's this like energy powder that people who like to lift weights use, called C4, that is just a billion percent of your daily recommended allowance of caffeine. And you mix it with water, shake it up, and you get a lemony flavoured energy boost. And within half an hour, you are wired. Doesn't sound very healthy, though. It's called C4 because it apparently gives you an explosive workout. Not really something I want to try.
It sounds miserable.
Give you explosive something else.
Yeah. Oh, man. Good old 3 hours, 23 minutes, and 20 seconds to go. This is actually the closest two cars are on track here. AB Racing Silver and Racemore Kraut.
Who's our closest battle on track? I would say it's Racemore Kraut Racing, Thomas Facklem, who's catching AB Racing Silver. 1.1 seconds behind AB Racing Silver. Ricardo Ferreira currently driving that car.
Yeah, they have a 16-lap tire difference. That is definitely one reason he's catching them.
Yep. Yeah, AB Racing Silver pitted 22 laps ago. So... And Kraut Racing only 6 laps ago, so yeah, the fresh tyres should see him make a fairly easy pass.
Let's see an overtake here. I'll put my arms up and cheer. There's actually another car not even 1.5 seconds ahead of AB Racing Silver as well, so.
Yeah, Pure Racing 2. Yeah, Pure Racing 3, Mert Uzel, who's 19 laps into his stint. That is the blue BMW you might see occasionally in the shop. So yep, Thomas Fatclam in that black, silver, blue and white Kraut Racing BMW. He made a good video actually after the Suzuka round, a good montage of their race.
Yeah, a lot of ups and downs.
Yeah, they weren't ashamed to show a few of the crashes they had as well, which are pretty spectacular. But they meant it to the end. Yeah, search for Kraut Racing on YouTube and you'll be able to find that.
I don't know if you saw that there, AB Racing Silver have a little wiggle on the exit. The fact they got their right side tires on the turf.
Yep, that's a place that's claimed a few victims this race. Ooh,
oh, we actually just saw a car, yeah.
That was Phoenix Motorsports. Facing the wrong way, but the exit of Radior. They are moving again.
How did they... I'm gonna see if I can get a replay out of this. I doubt I can, but I'm going to try. Let's see here. Oh, I can.
It was the longest slide in the world. So yeah, I think they were entering a drifting championship. Let's see what happens.
Exiting. Oh! Alright, they're about to hit the wall. They did hit the wall. Oh, they hit both walls.
Yeah. Quite lucky, really, that no one else... and then the Quanda car went past immediately afterwards.
Yes, and then a very nice job here of waiting. NX Racing blue car had passed. Wow, they drove way up. But I see what they're doing. They're making it so where they can easily spin the car around. Very nice job by them.
Yeah, it was good.
Patience. Now that car is not that badly damaged. And it is, but it could be a lot worse.
Another battle that's going to be worth keeping an eye on in a... you know, few laps time is the sixth place battle. Virgil Racing currently catching Team Camara. The gap is about 16 seconds, or 15 and a half seconds now. And yeah, the gap is going down by about half a second lap or more.
Just want to note also the top two teams. Going to SimSport actually have shrunk the lead down to about 1:46. It was as high as 1:55.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, close to 10 seconds off this stuff.
Yeah, that's the smallest gap we've seen in hours between the first two.
Yeah, which is insane to think that they've really only been within like a 5 second gap between 1:50 and 1:55 for 6 hours or so.
Yeah, incredibly similar pace from the front runners, as it were. And again, it's probably more just that Coanda had that incident early on. That's why it's been hanging between 1:46 and 1:55, as opposed to just 6 to 10 seconds kind of thing.
Yeah, I'd like to think what it would be like if that didn't happen. How close it would actually be.
Probably close enough to make you a lot more nervous than you currently are about in exercise.
That's very true.
Maybe that'd be good, it'd be keeping you awake.
Oh, that's true as well.
Maybe tell Lauren to just back it off a bit.
No, that's not how this works. Actually, I mean, like I said before, I haven't really talked to him much at all. Actually, I haven't messaged him once this entire race. Timu messaged me once just for an X-Racing Blue, where they didn't actually, the car didn't refuel for some reason, so they had to do a whole lap and then it pits again. But outside of that, I haven't got anything. And also Jack, who didn't have permission to join the channel, the NX Racing channel, so I moved him in TeamSpeak. That's it. Only communication we've had all race.
Seems fair. Just a note, hang on, what are they doing? Glacier Racing. Yeah, they're definitely out at this point.
Yeah,
that car parked in the pit lane.
Both the 41 of Glacier Racing and the number 9 of Pure Racing Team 2, we see AB Racing Silver, AB Racing Silver just pit out of the 17th position. So Racemore Kraut Racing have it. Now going to charge after Pure Racing 3. But yeah, number 9, Pure Racing 2, and number 41 of Glacier Racing, they both got a pit bug. Turned out to be pretty much the exact same bug at very similar times, which has basically locked them in their pit stall. They can't go anywhere.
Did Pure Racing disconnect all their drivers? That still don't work.
Yes, they did. They even tried to withdraw them all and then have only one person join, and that didn't seem to work, which is really weird because that worked for Suzuka. So I'm guessing the update that happened between the two races, maybe that changed something and possibly removed the workaround for it, which was leaving and then rejoining. So they need to just fix it completely now to where that doesn't happen.
Yeah, that's a really, really bad bug.
Yeah, a toe bug or something like that, sure, you lose 40 seconds, okay. But when you literally just have someone locked in their pit stall and they have to miss the last, 6 hours of the race, especially, well, Glacier had the crash, I understand. You know, they're still running third. And that's just insult to injury right there. And Pure Racing Team 2, I don't even think they even had damage. I don't know what happened, but they just got locked in their pit stall. Which they've been running in the top 15 literally all race long.
You're still looking at Kraut Racing, Thomas Facklin, chasing down Mert Uzel, Pure Racing Team number 3. This is for 16th position. Again, Kraut Racing only 9 laps into their stint, whereas Pure Racing are 22 laps in, so again, fresher tyres should see them through.
Yeah, for sure. Also, while watching this, the Phoenix Motorsports car, which we saw was damaged, they did get passed by R4R Motorsports. Number 4 car, BMW. Currently though, Phoenix looks like they're getting used to the car again. Still a little slow, but able to pop off respectable lap times until they pit again to possibly fix the car. Who knows if they will though, with 3 hours remaining. I say only 3 hours remaining now, but I think they just don't want to mess up their pit strategy. Try to pit in 13 minutes or so they know they can make it to the end. On 2 more pit stops.
Yeah, makes sense.
And also, I know I'm really tired because this coffee is actually kind of good right now.
It making a difference, is it?
I think it is. I can actually, my brain feels like it's sort of functioning. I'm not a believer in coffee by any means, but, I think the mix of water and some coffee, and now I have a little food as well, I can live.
Do you have anything you have to do on Monday?
I'm going to work. I'm going to be up at 7 in the morning.
Oh, boy.
Which, I don't know how that's going to work exactly, since I'm probably going to sleep all today. So, therefore, I don't know how I'm going to go to sleep tonight.
I think you'll have to get up and then get up at like 2 a.m. and just stay awake until Monday
that's
night.
That's going to be a problem. That's an endurance race in itself right there. Deco has to rub it in. Thank you, Deco. You're off Monday. Yeah, thanks. Just rub it in.
As long as your job doesn't involve operating heavy machinery.
No, I'm a computer engineer, so I just program stuff all day.
That's all right, then. You'll go back to your work on Tuesday and wonder what the hell you've been doing.
Yes, that's going to be true. Work's probably going to hate me on Monday because they're going to be like, you know, what are you doing? Because I'll be just sitting there dead at my computer. Probably be a good thing. Then I can just show them YouTube videos. I'm like, yeah, that was me all race. Yeah.
Tell them you programmed the corner cutting thing as well.
And reprogrammed IRTVO to work. I wish Nick Thyssen, I hope I said that properly, sorry if I did not, did his programming beforehand. We ended up having pretty much the same exact process, kind of sharing actually what we've used. And also the whole live timing thing, I pretty much kind of changed some stuff in there to make things work. For example, the pit stops and also the stint length. Had to find some stuff. Pretty simple stuff.
Yeah, I think after the stint length has been much more reliable this time around.
Yeah. I don't know what it is with iRacing and the pitting. I think it's simply because just the pit number I get is wrong. Like when they're pitting, when it's supposedly pitting. So I need to find a way of making it more promising of when they're really pitting so I can count the number of times they pit. Because as you can see, it says currently the NX Racing Reds had 23 pit stops, and that's not right. They haven't had more, four more pit stops in Coanda. So something's going on there. Just need to check it out, basically.
Yeah.
To figure out a more stable way of doing it. It's sort of like what I had to do with the off-track software. I noticed, I mentioned Nick Thyssen again, I believe he was the one that created the one for Neo. What they were doing is they were checking to see when you go off track, if you are off track for more than 2 seconds, then it counts it again. And what they're also doing is they're checking it across the entire circuit. And the situation with that is the fact of the off tracks that you see, how can I say it? The off tracks that you see in the software are, even if you're stopped, you're gonna get an off track. So if you're stopped on the side of the track for, let's say, 60 seconds, it's gonna report 30 off tracks to their software. And I'm not sure if they know that or not. I'm hoping they do. But, you know, it's just, you know, something that may happen. And that may be why they're seeing reports of extremely high incidents. We just see Pure Racing Team 3 their pit stop. But that may be why they're seeing extremely high incidents when, you know, that's not really the case. I chose a different route, so I made sectors, and then you can only get one off track per sector per lap. So it was more of a bulletproof way of, you know, doing things. I also wanted to make it to where you had to be over a certain speed, so then I really know if you were spinning or if you were, you know, driving your heart out. But that's a bit too difficult since iRacing doesn't display the speed of each car. You kind of have to guess using what's the measurement of speed? Come on, guys, you know physics.
Measurement of speed.
Yeah.
Meters per second.
Pretty much. So distance over time.
Oh, that's what you're looking for. Sorry, yeah. I gave you the unit you're looking for. So.
Yeah. Well, it's the same thing in the end.
True.
So that's how they actually calculated an IRTVO, and I'm guessing other software programs, except, I don't really want to do that. I don't know if that's really the best way of doing it, because it's more of a guess. I don't know if teams are actually doing 200 kph or not. They may be doing 197, and because of that, you know, it might falsely accuse them of something. So, I'm kind of, you know, that worried about falsely accusing somebody, so... I've seen it happen before, so it's not something I want to experience myself.
Yeah. Well, it seems to be working pretty well so far.
Yeah. I know Boothie has said that he's had quite a bit of warnings to give out, and we've seen a couple, or quite a few penalties given out as well for it. I know right now he's so tired that I have no idea what he's doing. He said, I messaged him earlier to see if he was still awake, and he said that he was just about to fall asleep in his chair. So I think I woke him up for at least another 3 minutes. He's probably asleep by now in his chair. Gave him a tough job though. We're kind of weak right now in the amount of admins we have. We got some people to help as well, but you know they're not going to be as dedicated all 24 hours like we are. So it's literally just been me, Jonathan Palmer, and Boothie, Michael Booth, pretty much the entire 24 hours.
Help wanted.
It could be. It's more the thing of, you know, we can't go and ask teams for, you know, the entry fee and all that. We don't really want to do that, especially when there's 120 teams fighting for 60 spots. So, you know, we can't go out there and pay for a racing broadcast because of that. So we do it in-house, and that really restricts our admining abilities, I guess you can say. You can admin, and Michael Booth's done a great job admining, no doubt about it. It's just, you know, it's difficult. Jonathan Palmer has to jump in between. Thankfully, you guys are here right now, so, you know, he can help Michael as much as possible right now.
Hopefully, Lewis McLeod will be joining soon as well, so
yeah,
that I can go and get some lunch.
Or I can just go on really long tangents like I just did, and this race will be over in no time.
That's good. I mean, there's not much going on the circuit, so now is the time for tangents.
Yeah, I guess another one is Jonathan Palmer just typed to us in TeamSpeak chat. We used to actually have a lot of admins and Lift for Speed. Most of them, you know, like in 24 hours, for example, someone in a team's driving like 4 hours of the race, we'll see them admin for like 6 or so hours, simply because, you know, most of the people there, they're not going to be biased. They don't care. Most of them are just doing it for fun. And you know, they're going to look and see, you know, who's done what wrong. And when you have 5 people reviewing incidents, then you can really tell that no bias is really going to be had. It's going to, you know, be correctly called on. And now we have Michael Booth, who's doing a lot of, probably the main person who reviews the incidents. So he has no bias. He doesn't really care who it is. He'll penalize any of you. So I guess that's a good thing, really. Keeps everyone in line. Probably. I mean, he takes out whatever anger he has at a specific team just when he gets to penalize them. Yeah. He's probably sitting there. He probably has like a whiteboard or something, and he like marks off each team when he gets to penalize them and does a little fist pump.
The Scottish fist pump.
Exactly.
Which is actually just punching someone.
A very quiet Scottish fish pump, if you ever heard.
Fish
pump? Fish pump. Yeah, I can't speak either. Fist pump.
Speaking of Scottish,
yes.
What is... Who is it? Wait, who am I thinking of?
Good
is
one.
It Paul DiResta? Am I thinking
of
Paul DiResta?
He's Scottish.
Right? He's Scottish or is he British? I mean, when he's good, he's British, but...
Well, that's so, Andy Murray, isn't it?
Wait, that's Andy Murray, too. I was going to ask that the next one.
Yeah. If he loses, he's Scottish, but if he wins, then we accept that he could also be British.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah, it's one of us.
I think Paul DiResta ever reached that level of national, I should say, fame for us to have the same joke going on about it.
Well, he qualified good a few races, and then I think when he qualified good a few races, I know Autosport and whatnot mentioned British. We actually had this discussion on TeamSpeak one day. It was pretty good about the different things, and I think I even went as far as saying that Nico Rosberg is definitely not even Finnish whatsoever. Sorry if anybody believes that he may be. You have all rights to believe that. However, his dad is from Sweden and his mom is German and pretty much lived in Monaco his entire life. So, just my opinion.
Yeah. Well, what was it? Back when Sean Edwards was about, he was obviously from the United Kingdom, but raced at least in a couple of the Porsche Super Cup seasons he did as a Monegasque because he had lived in Monaco so long. So
yeah. Just like Romain Grosjean, he starts his career out, he's Swiss. And then suddenly he goes to Formula One, and his total sponsorship is French. So
yeah, that's so weird.
He has a French background, but still, I mean, if it's kind of weird how you can change, you know, what you are. I have a Spanish background. I have family from Spain, yet I'm still going to categorize myself as an American. Do I choose to? I guess I do, but yeah, it's whatever.
I currently live in Wales for 9 months of the year, but that doesn't mean I'm going to categorize myself as Welsh.
I was going to ask if you're a anyway. Whale, but I guess that would be offensive.
Only moderately. I've been called worse, so...
Wow. So, I'm just looking to see... It's getting into that point to where you just see what the stints are here. And it looks like... Yes, it looks like both... Actually, hold on, let me double check this one more time. Okay, so all the teams in the top 13, I would say. No, sorry, all the teams in the top 15 are going to be having two more pit stops. Every single one of them. NX Racing currently stopping right now. They're going to be the first. And then after that, we're going to see Coanda, Virgil Racing, and Radicals Online 2. And also Phoenix Motorsports.
And then after that, they'll have two more pit stops.
Yeah, they're... Yeah. No, sorry. No, this is... Yeah, you're right.
This would be the first of three pit stops that everyone needs to make, right?
Yes, my bad. After this pit stop here, then they have two more. Apologies, yes. 3 hour mark, 2 hour mark, 1 hour mark. Or as some would look at it, since this is a 24-hour race, 21-hour mark, 22-hour mark, 23-hour mark. Mad props still to all 38 cars that are still running. Still quite a bit.
Sounds like a reasonable number.
Yeah, we're looking at... I was just checking because I saw the gap of Core Motorsports and NX Racing Blue. Maybe, you know, pit stop differences. However, that's not going to be a case. So I don't think there's going to be any surprises when it comes to pit stops. Paulo Brink currently in the pits for Radicals Online 2. I think they realize the situation that they're in.
I always get confused between Paulo Brink and Dave Gehling.
Which, by the way, Dave has just entered the car. And just a random fact here. Martin Kronk for Coanda Simsport is ahead. Is that going to last long? Unfortunately not, but only for this lap, I believe he will be pitting this lap.
Yeah, he's started his 26th lap of the stint. I'm pretty sure that's the limit for BMW.
Yeah, and the Coanda car is 1.7 seconds ahead of Dave Gehling's NX Racing red car. In fact, they can see each other, but yeah, Kronka will be pulling off into the pits the next time around. So at the moment we're going to be pausing the stream for the benefit of uploading it to YouTube. It should not take more than a couple of seconds, and it should automatically restart, but if it doesn't, refresh the page. And we'll be heading into the final 3 hours of this Masters of Endurance 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing.
Yeah, I just want to give a shout out to them. Actually, you'll see a little graphic here on the bottom right of the screen. Blue Flag Racing.
Yep. Providing the to find the prize money for this race. And they are, as Coanda pulls into the pit lane there for another pit stop, they're supplying the prize money. And they're on a recruitment drive. So if you want to get involved, Blue Flag Racing on Facebook is the place to go. So we're going to welcome back into the commentary box Lewis McGlade, who has, I guess, woken up. I'm assuming, obviously awake, because he's right here.
Yeah, it was woken up, has returned to see the final 3 hours of the race.
The prodigal son.
Indeed. Hello.
Hello.
As you can see, probably from the last time you're in the commentary box, everything has changed, nothing is as it seems. Various big names have been in walls and upside down. I believe I told you about Team Redline's demise last night.
You did tell me about the Redline thing. I woke up to see the Glacier Racing has disappeared from the top five.
They had a crash, but then Alexi is asleep and connected to the server, and they're stuck in the pit box, and they need him to leave before it would be possible for them to rejoin and drive the car again.
I don't think that would work, because the number 9 car has already tried that.
Oh, okay.
And it didn't work either.
Is it completely done? Completely.
Yeah, it seems like it's literally stuck. They have some form of pit bug to where their car will not move out of their pit stall, no matter what they do.
Oh, well, that's a shame.
Yeah, it's completely ridiculous, to be honest.
Yeah. We also see that Koana SimSport in P2 after their early troubles. And good job to return from that, although they've entered the pit lane according to live timing.
Yes, they've actually just switched to Klaus Kubikus. Still on the pit lane, haven't left just yet.
Of course, we're expecting them to fall quite a way behind the NX Racing red car again.
Yeah, actually, they gained. Well, we'll see here. Just after they get out of the pits, I'll switch to the comparison so you can see for yourself on stream. Oh. Minute 40 seconds. Remember, it was all the way up to a minute 55, so in 15 seconds last stint that Martin Kronk just closed in on.
Yes, but I'm wondering. Not bad.
Yeah, what I'm wondering, I don't know if they want to do it or not, but if Klaus drove this stint and then Martin drove the last two, unless Klaus can match Martin's pace, so then by all means do it. But if not, try to have Martin in for the last two stints, see what he can gain. Maybe he can get it down to a minute or something. You never know what could happen.
The last time Klaus was in the car, he was doing mid-19s. It was mid to upper 19s and low 20s for the most of his stint. So he's a little slower than Krunker was in this most recent stint.
I think he'll probably be of a very similar pace to Dave Gelling, to be honest.
Yeah, that's what I think is going to happen here. And you know, because of that, you don't really gain. And that's the thing that's been really happening over the whole entire night. This past 7-8 hours, there hasn't really been anything between, outside of 1 minute 50 seconds and 1 minute 55 seconds. It's been that pretty much the entire time, because the drivers that have been driving for both teams have been completely even. And now you have Klaus Kubikus and Martin Kronk getting back into the car, especially Martin getting back into the car, and now suddenly they're closing the gap a little bit. We'll see here if Klaus can close in on Dave or not.
Yeah, Dave. Yeah, pretty much. The last time he drove, he was lap 316 to lap 341. And yeah, he's pretty much consistently, possibly slightly slower over the course of a stint. Maybe 5 seconds slower over the course of a stint than Klaus. But yeah, it'll be a very minor difference.
That's interesting, actually. We see the gap, and this is actually really fun. I gotta show this. Okay, so the gap between first and second, around minute 40, minute 39, and then the gap between second and third, just how it happens to be a minute 39, and then the gap between third and fourth, almost, but it's a minute 36. So, pretty interesting comparison there.
And then Iberica ruined it by being only 16.3 behind Jack.
What's wrong with you, Iberica? Come on.
Yeah, fall back a bit.
15 seconds? I mean, you guys got to fall back a minute and 20 seconds. No, they've done a great job. They've had a couple drive-thrus for exceeding track limits, and they've pretty well fixed that up. Still a couple that's been pretty borderline. I think Boothie's given them the benefit of the doubt.
The difference between the performance of fifth place Iberica Danilo Jacobs and in X Racing Blues Jack Sedgwick, they're pretty much, again, pretty even pace wise over the course of a stint.
Yeah, so over the course of a stint, I noticed they're on different strategies though, by the looks of it.
In the final 3 hours is where, like, the previous 21 hours, as it were, has set you up strategy-wise for the end of the race. So, you know, it's just hoping that everyone's got it right and has picked the right moment. I'm sure when you put this much work into it, yeah, you're going to have thought about every loophole and loose end. And, you know, it's been a long day for these people. This is where it gets very, very easy to make a mistake when, you know, you're getting a bit tired behind the wheel, you know, the day's been long, and you know how much work there's been put into this, so it's going to get very easy for some of these guys to make a mistake, and we just hope that no one actually does in the final 3 hours of the race.
Yeah, and I don't know how many hours Scott Michaels has done of this race. I know you guys can probably see the entries list to see how many laps. Actually, I might be able to do that. He's done 316 laps.
Good lord.
Scott Michaels by himself. Now, I know last race they switched, but like they switched on the same computer. I don't think they're doing that this race.
That's a crazy amount of time. I remember doing that and helping out with the endurance race where one of my friends did 13 of the 24 hours. And yeah, it is like, it just ruins you for like days because, you know, it's just a horrible feeling afterwards. You know, you're so exhausted from turning laps of the same track. I would be surprised if he ever would enjoy driving Spa again. After so long driving around so many laps, you know, when I do a sim race event, I'll throw a couple of hundred laps, but all in one go.
He drove 6 hours straight earlier.
Oh God! No, yeah. I could never do that.
It was like 180 laps or something crazy like that. I think so, 180, 155. Just had a number yelled in my ear.
That's very impressive to have done that many laps. I could not keep focused for that long without winning it. I would have found a wall and dumped it in it fairly soon.
Yeah. I was just checking to see what they will be possibly reaching with this driver to see if he's going to go over the specified amount of laps. I'm just kind of guessing now what the total number of laps is. All I know is he better not go over 380 laps driven by himself, because if he does, he's going to definitely have a penalty for driving a bit too much. So he probably wants to have another driver do a stint here shortly.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. You don't want to throw you know your current result away on a technicality, because no one else was about to do laps. So hopefully they do have another driver around somewhere to get in that car, as he has put in an awful lot of work. From what I can see, he's only three and a bit seconds behind an actual car for position, so is fairly close to one.
Yeah, he's been quick too. I mean, it's, and he hasn't really made any mistakes. Definitely the Ironman award right now, that's for sure.
So we're just going to do a brief fade to black, cut the stream, and then come back. We'll be away for a couple of seconds. So join us again in a second for the 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing.